bad news is we only have 21 days left to December 21st. The good news is there's a lot of momentum, and we're going to make it. So everything's great. We've had some remarkable expansions of clarity, and you know, conversation words can only go so far. They really fail to encompass the scope and depth and integral nature of seeing clearly. It seems subtle, and that's been happening to me the last several days, just suddenly seeing the full scope of the play of belief, the play of the intellect, the attempt to fix problems, and the attempt to deal with this hypothetical scenario, this hypothetical problematic scenario. I just see it's all of this. It's all of this. And seeing that, and just saying, wow. How do you convey that in words? You cannot be done. You can only reassurance that it's there to see can be given. And my response to it, I can tell you my response to it was, yeah, I want more of this. This is what I love. I love to see this. Now, the intellect thinks that what's beyond the intellect or what it's attempting to replace is crazy, because it says, oh, I love to see how the intellect is just a hypothetical. And the intellect says, what? The intellect believes it's protecting us from this craziness. It really does. So we run back into the arms of our protector, what claims to be our protector, what believes to be our protector, but we don't need protecting. So the issue of protector is a false issue. If we did need protecting, then that would be a different story, but we don't. What we are doesn't have any problems. It doesn't need protection from anything. So we don't need to run back into the arms of belief, the intellect, because it's there offering its services to us. It says, I know how to protect you. Don't worry, I'll protect you. But the protection is always in the future, isn't it? It says, well, you need to do some things first to be protected. You need to earn your protection, and the protection is never there. What we need is, what we are doesn't need any protection from anything. But we certainly need to disengage from the protector, what is claiming to protect us and help us, the helper, the protector, all of that. Now God, the Prime Creator, knows that we have affection, some attachment to this hypothetical scenario, so We don't want to just drop it and have it just vanish like a mirage. So God puts an overlay over this mirage. This is just a mirage. It is a mirage. It's a hallucination. But God says, okay, you have affection for your hallucination because it's something that you have, feel you've created or been involved with that, to try and create it. And so let's just put this seamless, perfect overlay over all of it. And that way you will know that you're, nothing is attacked. In reality, doesn't attack anything, including your dreams of insanity. Does not attack that either. And so we're good with that. We say, yeah, that's sufficient. That's fine. But words cannot convey this situation properly, which is why I keep saying we need a big boost. A big boost means that which is beyond words. A situation here where someone is fundamentally established in that which is beyond words and has no attachment to words whatsoever, and then simply can use them practically, but there's no attachment there. And then we can get this greater reassurance, greater encouragement that we can go beyond these words. Just one second here. Okay. And we're getting very close, very close. The last several days have been very close for me. And I'm getting a little irritated and frustrated because, wow, this is like the brass ring is right there. And you have to just be patient, and you cannot jump go to the intellect and say, okay, come on, let's push it through or something, because the intellect then will say, ah, you need to go plant a million flowers. And that's what it'll do. It'll say, go out and plant these bulbs. I got hundreds and hundreds of bulbs. I got them for very cheap. The intellect says, look at all these bulbs. You can plant the whole yard. You got hundreds and hundreds of bulbs. Go out there and plant them all. And then the spring, boom, all these flowers will come up and people will see and say, oh my gosh, look at all the color. You know, look how happy they must be to live in the house. The people there must be so happy. They must be problem free. So really what the intellect does is try to generate the image of problem freeness, which is why we're all obsessed with celebrity culture, because the whole purpose of celebrities is to provide an image of problem freeness, which we want to be free of problems. It's just that we're going about it the wrong way. The way to be free of problems is to recognize we never had any in the first place. And that is what the enlightened ones have been telling us forever. That's it. It's so simple. The dichotomy is so simple, you can easily see there's a huge difference. One says, yes, problems are real, but there's a way to get rid of them. The other says, no, problems are not real. You never had any. Therefore, why do you need to make efforts to get rid of them? You don't. You don't. The world can remain exactly as it is now and accept the overlay, and the overlay is more beautiful than if you planted flowers. If the whole planet was blooming with flowers, the overlay would be way more attractive than that. There's no way that we can even approximate the attractiveness of the overlay, and yet the intellect is frantically trying to do so, because it feels this attraction back to the overlay as a threat that you're about to lapse into insanity. And so it desperately says, come on everyone, let's get this network here, all the satellites and optic cables and smartphones and Facebook, everything. Let's everybody get on the same page and let's all go out and plant. Let's make let's turn this world into a utopia. That's what it wants to do. That's the intellect. The attempts to turn this world into a utopia are the intellect. And that's what I've been seeing. I've been seeing the entirety of it. Everything that we have been attempting to do is simply, again, the intellect. It is simply following this false plan of salvation, saying, yeah, problems are real, but here we can get rid of them by doing some endeavor, some effort. Of course, the reward is always in the future. It's not here now because we haven't done enough. And we're told if we just do enough, we'll not have any problems anymore, somehow, magically. If we look at it, we kind of say, wait a minute, it seems like a very sketchy plan. And yet, we continue to go for that intensely, because the intellect tells us that on the other behind the intellect, behind the curtain, is complete insanity, meaning that no problem. And for the intellect, being born from the goal of solving problems, that's insanity. There's no such thing as no problems to the intellect. The intellect cannot appreciate it, cannot accept this, cannot. So it says, well, that's insanity. No, what it just means is it's just that we have no more use for the intellect. That's not insanity. You say, well, we don't have any use for it. No need for it. That's not insanity at all. But the intellect perceives it that way, saying, well, then the problems will just pile up on you and you won't have anyone to help you solve them and you're going to be buried in infinite problems. And so that's crazy to go in that direction. And you say, no, there aren't any problems in reality. You won't be buried by any problems. You don't need anything to help you solve problems. And you won't, so there you go. You're free of delusion. But the courage to look is what's required. And how do you get that courage to look? That is the huge question. How do you get the courage to look and see? Now, most people stay on the conceptual level. That's the problem throughout history, is everyone's been trying to grasp it in a quote-unquote safe and sane manner, which is to not actually see it. Because when you see it, it's like you feel like you're on the verge of freedom from it. You say, oh, that is how it is. Now I see. Whereas conceptually, you're not seeing at all. It's a substitute for seeing. Which is what the educational system of the planet has always been like that, really, now more so than ever, is let's not really see, let us just conceptualize everything. And the seeing is not a perceptual seeing, it's a inherent recognition by our spirit. Our spirit recognizes. We become aware of recognizing, not perceptually aware, but really aware. It's like, let's say there's a dream figure in a dream, and the dream figure is trying to see better in the dream. Say, okay, how do I see the dream better? And it's not the dream figure that needs to see the dream, it's the dreamer that needs to see what the dream is. Dream figures trying to see what the dream is complete waste of time, which is what we've been doing conceptually. We're trying to get a concept. Okay, this is a dream, and I'm dreaming. How do I see this better conceptually in the dream? No, the figures in the dream cannot see what the dream, what it really is, actually is. Only the dreamer can. So it's the dreamer that needs the courage to recognize that they're dreaming. And so I've been having these little epiphanies of recognizing the scope of it. And for a bit, I saw this whole thing as it's like a dream. It's hard to explain, except that. And then it just, you know, faded a little bit. It didn't affect me anyway, except to say, hey, I want to see that again. I want to see that. That's great. But as far as, you know, shaking you up or something, no, not really. It's pretty much what you expect as far as, you know, there's something that needs to be seen. And then you see it, you get a glimpse of it, and you say, oh, okay, it's there. How do I get back? Why did it fade? And then you have to try to get back to it. And that requires what's called certain patience, not panicking, not getting frustrated. Realizing that it wasn't a fluke, it wasn't some kind of cosmic alignment that brought this about. And therefore you don't have to really wait. There's no need to wait. Because we're not sure how it came about, and so we just imagine that there's something that brought it about out of our control, and who knows if it'll ever come again. But you have to reject that and say, no, that is not accurate at all. Not accurate. I know how it came about is that I saw conceptually, I saw how it's impossible to have problems. Problems are unreal. Therefore, there can't be any actual real problems. And from that, I then got the courage to look. And so let's, and then see how does it feel, and then how does it feel, and then the scope of it. I was able to see the scope of it. So that's how it happened. It wasn't anything luck or anything like that. No luck involved. One reaches a point where they just say, "Okay, how does this feel? Let's feel how the problem free state. Let's feel that." And yesterday I was recognizing that. If I have a problem free state, it must be that I'm not a body. I can't be a body if I'm problem free. How can I have a body? I must not be a body at all. Must be immortal spirit. And that needs to be the experience. And so there is this sort of closing in towards this acceptance. But who knows how fast it will go? I don't know. But the path does take this extraordinary patience, really. So what I did after seeing this, what I did last night, here's an example of, I went back retrospect on music and the music that influenced me. I was trying to say, to see where did this intellect arise? When did it arise? When did I engage with it? It's not my intellect, it's the intellect. I came into the world, the activity of the world, the purposeful solve problemsness of the world is the intellect. Let's solve problems. There are problems. Problems are real, but we're here to solve them, that kind of thing. And so you're welcome into the world, and people say, oh, thank you for being here. How are you going to help us solve these real problems? And then at some point you start engaging with this, and then it seems as if that is your identity. Because you're so identified with solving problems, you assume that this problem-solving agenda is your identity. We don't realize that it is not. It's a tool. We're identifying with this tool and thinking that the tool is what we are. It is not. So I was looking back at the music, and I came across some very interesting stuff. When you're young, the music is very powerful. It's like a super drug. And of course, the intellect knows that extremely well, which is why enormous emphasis is placed on music in this world, to make sure music is available to the young. And it's hooked into movies and advertising, commercialism, materialism, consumerism, every type of programming and indoctrination that's carried out here uses music and attractive bodies, music and attractive bodies, which the young are very vulnerable to those things, very vulnerable. So I was going back, and I felt like I was getting very close to recognizing, when did I grab a hold of the intellect? How did I get seduced into that? Because I wasn't supposed to do that. I was determined not to do that, and yet I did, which is very disappointing. And it had somewhat to do with the music of the times. And I came across some pretty amazing stuff. Pretty amazing stuff. Sometimes there's singers, or there's a sound that grips you. And I did come across something I never knew before that was a very, very powerful grip. The music of the time was a very powerful drug, extremely powerful drug, and it was better than we expected. It caught me off guard, really caught me off guard. Music does that. I know people say they love music, but I tell you this: if you got a glimpse of the freedom that is yours, you would not trade that freedom in for all the music in the world. You'd no way, and. I feel like an idiot for doing that. And I was listening to music, and I say, well, it's really a kind of bellowing. It's a kind of the whooping and the bellowing and the swooping and all this stuff. And it's got this kind of a animalistic, jingly, jangly whoop to it. And I was studying the wall of sound. The wall of sound was very big when I was growing up. I was Phil Spector, the wall of sound, and the Gold Star Studios down, and Capitol Studios down, and the Beach Boys tried to recreate the wall of sound, and they had all these, you know, the A-Team, the Wrecking Crew musicians, studio musicians, but they also had backup singers. And the way they incorporated those backup singers, layering it, behind the lead singers, they did such a good job, and that it created this symphonic kind of mini symphonies, and it was like, wow, it was like a black hole that you just like get pulled into this. It was very bad, as far as being seductive, very bad. It's better to have bad music than good, I'll tell you that. I mean, that may seem strange too, but it really is, because I always curse the day that I feel I got sucked into the music, because I lost my awareness of reality. I traded it in for, I thought, oh no, I'm just embracing this music, but I didn't realize this music was completely tied into this Moloch of the intellect, of belief, of this hypothetical scenario. It's, you know, drug pushers are very clever. Very clever, and they find ways to get you hooked, and music was the way to hook us. It really was the way to hook us. Got hooked by music. Music was the hooker. It's the ultimate hooker. It's the ultimate hooker. And these these producers are just pimps for the intellect, pimping out these hookers, these songs to hook us in. And they will use anyone who has that. They're very keen on a sound that can start reverberating and capturing us and pulling us into that. And then once we're pulled into that, then we start thinking, hey, we have a way to solve the problems of the world. And we just need to spread this music everywhere, which is what I felt. That's what happened. I felt I can just spread song everywhere. I was so completely wrapped up in music. Saw everything, the entire world I saw in terms of music. And the only important things were musical performances, concerts, who was playing where. We wanted to just spread this music into every living room in the world. Live music and just compelling stuff. Wanted to teach everybody how to be great musicians, great singers, all these things. You just get totally wrapped up in it. And it's not, you don't realize that this is simply the intellect. You're trying to solve problems. And you think you have the magic fairy dust to solve the problems, and you don't. But boy, are we vulnerable when we're young to that. And boy, is that exploited to the max. To the max. You have a lot of magicians. Don't call them musicians, call them magicians. Magicians exploit this to the max. Which is why in times past, kids were brought up, they didn't have radio. The concerts, whatever they had was church music, but it wasn't the church music of the day. It was the sort of different tonal systems, Gregorian tonal system, whatever you call it, that are entirely different. They don't give rise to the kind of jingly-jangly go-go feeling that we have now, whatever the different feelings that music give rise. No, it's very different, very kind of solemn, with lots of spaces, and it doesn't stir up the enthusiasm to go solve the problems of the world. It turns you more towards contemplative quiet and saying to recognize the problems. There aren't any real problems. And the world itself, the fact that we're not solving any of these quote-unquote problems is not a problem at all. We can literally drop all effort to solve any more problems, and that's not a problem because the overlay will just overlay everything. So in the past, people did not have this type of entertainment, a lot of places, and it was frowned upon, which it should be frowned upon, because it's ruinous as far as our salvation goes, as far as getting free of this delusion that we have problems, because it's kind of like we're we're handed some sweets, and then we're told we have a sweet tooth, and that's why that we have the sweets. In other words, a sweet tooth is problems. But here's a sweet to cure the problem of the sweet tooth. The only problem is then you crave more, and you crave more, and you crave more. The delusion is that you there is some need for this stuff. There's some application for it. There's none. There's no real application at all to this world. None. So we have all this stuff. Maybe there's an induction. How I got induced into it was say, look at all this great stuff. There must be a use for all this stuff, a real use for it. Can you find a use for this? Well, in order to find a use for it, you have to assume there is a use for it, which then makes problems real. But there isn't any real use for it whatsoever. None. It's like someone handing you all these bulbs to plant and say, well, I gotta plant them. There's a need to plant them. There's not a need to plant anything here. There's not a need to create any music. There's not a need to do anything. And the overlay is already there. And the overlay, again, is what we really want to experience. And overlays everything, the whole universe overlays it all. So we don't need to feel like being something we tried to create as being attacked or dismissed or anything. No, it's just being overlaid. So what I'm doing is sort of showcasing here, how do you go about when you get real close here, how do you go about being patient and parsing it, looking at it and saying, wait a minute, okay, now how did I get induced into this? There's some tricky way. and you feel the music and on the effect on the body, the music and your emotions and everything, and you think, wow, if I could somehow, there must be some use, need for this, or use for it. Everybody's so engaged in all this stuff. There must be some purpose for this world. You look at the world, everybody's so busy, and you start concluding, drawing this wrong conclusion from it all. In other words, if you have a means, you think, I have a means to help, you must think there's some need for the help. You then make up a need for what you have. Let's say you had a pill that you think, oh, this pill can cure something. I know it can. And you say, well, I need a disease to cure. So let's make up this disease, and then I'll have a cure for it. There's no disease here in the world. There's no problems whatsoever. There's none of that. Not really. It's all a mirage. It's all make-believe. It's all pretense. Pretense is not real. And reality is not threatened by pretense. And I discovered that there's some secrets of these music producers. And I'm starting to hear him, I'm starting to see him and say, ah. And then when you look at it, you see what's really going on, it kind of falls apart. The magic disappears. It was really magic. And it was amazing. I saw the studios where they record. I couldn't believe it. It's so small. I said, whoa. I mean, you look at like Motown, you look at like Wall Sound, you look at, and say, how do they do this? And I started listening, re-listening to these old songs that were powerful in the day. And I said, oh my gosh, I can hear the background singers. One of the secrets was a group called The Blossoms, which was a background singing group. And they were super, super good. And incredible, you know. And they sang on so many, 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 many songs and artists. The backup singers are actually more talented than the lead singers. That was one of the secrets of the industry. You had some incredibly good backup singers as a group, 3, 4. They're able to just this lush, and they were able to imitate the lead singers and give this lush background, fill out everything. And then the wall of sound was actually a small room with tons of musicians and music. And they're able to get this kind of reverberation and then somehow pull a sound out of that. And I could sort of see, I was listening. I said, oh my gosh. Oh my God. I had a completely wrong conception of it. Just a little dingy, small room packed with musical instruments. They packed them in there. And then they used the, I could see how they did it, the bottom end, thump a thump a thump, and then in the middle is this wall of sound, and at the top you have accents, and then you have a lead singer, but then you have these background singers blending and providing this, and it produced this kind of magical realm of sound. Very clever. It's like sugarcoating something. They were able to sugarcoat it. They're producing confections. Poison pills, really, but coated with all sorts of chocolate confection. And I heard the Motown sound. I said, ah, you know what? They had a studio. They had a way to generate this certain type of sound, and it was simply, it's probably, you know, it's not magical, or it's not, it just has, it has to do with the equipment of the time. Magnetic tape, the condenser based microphones and mixing consoles, and the blend of the electrical and the acoustical instruments, the pianos, and then the horn sections, and then you get a certain type of singing over that, and then the background harmonies and stuff, and it just produces a certain sheen to it. And we got taken in, generation. I got taken in by that. And looking back at it now, I say, oh my gosh. What a waste of time. What a waste of time. And then listening to some of the singers, I asked myself, is it really what we want to say? Oh, what did I accomplish in life? Oh, I sang a song. I sang a song. I sang this song many times. I sang songs. I think, wait a minute. Is that such a great accomplishment? I sang songs. I sang a song. I was popular because I sang this song, belted it out. I belted out a song. I could belt out some songs. Well, wait a minute. Now, when we're young and adolescent, our voice is all breaking up and pimply, but, you know, we're like idolize these smooth, glamorous song singers and this music. They just seem so they can belt it out, and they're so smooth and everything. And we think, wow, I just want to get through adolescence. How do I do that? And these songs have to do with adolescent angst, and yet you have this glamorous sound and singers that all seem so smooth and sexy and sophisticated and grown up, and you say, I want to listen to this. This is how I want to sound at some point. As we are going through puberty and all these changes, and we feel so awkward and uncoordinated. So we're super vulnerable that time to getting hooked into music, which then hooks us into other aspects of culture, which then hooks us into other aspects of culture, and then it becomes a whole net. It's like during that time of adolescence, we need to be protected from these incredibly, what would you call it? How do you put a word to it? Very shrewd people in industry that are exploiters. You need to be protected from these extremely exploitive and manipulative activity of the intellect that works through people and industries here. You need to be protected from that, shielded, isolated, insulated from it somehow. Until you settle down into young adulthood and you feel comfortable with yourself, and then you won't be so attracted to stuff that's designed to try and help you through that period, but actually it's hooking you into what the corporations, what culture, what the intellect wants you to get hooked into. You often see great teachers in the world come from isolated places. They grew up, they didn't have any music, they didn't have anything like we have here. And they go through and they're never bombarded by all this stuff. I mean, the world right now, Western culture, what we're bombarded with is simply, there's no word to describe it. You can say pathetic. You can say tragic, you can say ruinous, you could say extremely time-wasting, extraordinarily delaying. It is a rotten, stinking corpse of a culture right now, in terms of salvation. It doesn't even recognize the goal of salvation. It doesn't even recognize that there is a realization of a problem-free condition, that we can have that. It doesn't realize it, doesn't recognize it. And it's doing everything possible to pull us away from that. Everything possible. And the momentum is just, you cannot already put a number on it or a description of it, how bad it is. And all the while we're being told we're headed toward riches. Problem-solving riches. We're almost there. We've almost solved the problems. Everybody has a 10,000 songs in their MP3 player now. 1,000 channels on the television set. Hundreds of Xbox games. Facebook, Twitter. Thousand apps. Networking like crazy. All this stuff. We think we're almost there. Almost there. Got to be almost there. Now, almost there for the intellect means that we've almost forgotten the goal, the reality. We've almost forgotten that there's a realization that we must make and that we have, and that there is this overlay, there is this problem-free recognition. We've almost forgot all of this. And that to the intellect, that's salvation. Intellect just believes if we just completely somehow separate from reality where it will be saved. That's its goal. And what it does is aim for that goal. And it humors us and allows us to, it's like humoring a child wants to play in the sandbox, build castles in the sandbox. It humors us when we kind of be interested in spiritual topics, spirituality. It humors us, say, oh, yeah, okay. But what it's saying is, uh-oh, here you go again. I got to put up with this. Oh, boy. Going a little crazy again. I need to draw you back here. Listen to this song. Why don't you just listen to this song instead of talking about all this great, you know, crazy stuff and considering this crazy stuff, that stuff. There's nothing there. It's annihilation. Nothing there. Don't look. That's what culture says. Now you can listen to a great, you know, quote unquote great song, very lively, entertaining song, and then ask yourself, well, okay, so what? And we expect something. We wait. And well, where's the payoff? There isn't any. It's like drinking a soda pop. Soda pop, pop culture, soda pop. A pop, I wanna give you a pop. And you get this pop of caffeine, pop of sugar, pop of a song, a little pop of adrenaline, pop of some chemistry, and then what? The intellect says, well, you're supposed to be happy now. You say, but I'm not, I am? He says, yeah. And you say, well, how come I'm not happy? And the intellect says, well, you must still have some sort of deep-seated desire to, you know, be free, really, for realization. And you got to get rid of that. So have another pop. Listen to the radio, pop, 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 like that. And you're supposed to be happy and supposed to be free and supposed to be problem-free now. Huh? You know, that song's supposed to make you feel problem-free. And, of course, the advertisers make these musicians. They're all, you know, just, oh, man, the 60s, you're just hanging out on the beach, just in these real new cars, the clothes are wonderful, everyone's just singing and dancing and all tan and happy, and there's no problems at all. They lived in like a paradise, and you thought, hey, if I just get into this music, that'll happen to me too. That's what it's all about. And it didn't happen at all. I don't know if there was ever a more glamorous time than growing up in the 60s, coming of age in the 60s with the Southern California sound and the Motown sound, and then the Beatles came along and everything, but the Southern California thing was just potent. You know, just you get up in the morning, you hang out at the beach with all your friends and everybody's lean, thin, tan, muscular, athletic, and surfing. Going to drive-ins, driving these convertibles to drive-ins, and the weather is just like unbelievably perfect every day, and it's just you go to music, you're listening to all this great, super great, cool music, and everything is just unbelievable. You just feel like life is going to be incredibly great. We're on the verge of this, of making it, and then, wow. What a decline. What an unbelievable decline. And yet we were sold. We were sold all of that. There was the whammo frisbee and the hula hoop. And yeah, let's go to Bob's Big Boy and have the burgers and the relish. And go to the drive-in movie theaters under the gorgeous California evenings. And it was just the California sound was there, the mamas and the papas and the Beach Boys and the wall of sound and the girl groups and the Tammy show and it's on and on and on and on. You just felt like you were on the verge of being problem free. That is exactly how we felt that time. So I said, okay, where's the problem freeness? I'm ready for it. I'm ready. Okay, when's it? Never happened. It never happened. I said, I was almost there, almost had it. And so I said, well, I better do something about it. I need to make a tremendous effort and then we'll get that. Because we felt we were on the verge of a global problem-free condition. If we could just bottle that elixir of the Southern California experience that was happening, if you could just bottle that, everyone's teeth were so white and perfect because of braces and orthodontics, etc. So pure, perfect. Everyone was so athletic. No obesity. You didn't see any obesity at that time down in the Southern California. I seen the way it was being shown to the world. Of course, Hollywood, all the movies, so glamorous, right? Everyone, Bel Air, Beverly Hills. Everyone was so beautiful. Of course, all airbrushed, made up, everyone was, it was all a facade. It was all super carefully constructed facade, but Technicolor, and it came in, and just everything was so vibrant. And the colors are so beautiful, and everything you see is the palm trees and the plants and the flowers. It was exactly like that. And then the young people were just like, seemed to have all they had was time on their hands. They didn't have to work, probably would never have to work. It just seemed like nobody was working. Everybody was just running around having fun. And the Beach Boy said, she'll have fun until her daddy takes the T-Bird away. And the T-Bird got taken away. And Brian Wilson went on to try to figure out how to get that final song, which he started. Substance abuse, trying to, they're all doing so much down there, so much substance abuse, because they were trying to find that final song. The final song. We all thought we were one song away. Really, listening to the radio, I felt that we were literally one song away from bliss, from permanent, no more problems. One song away. Because here's the thing, we know we're just one choice away from problem-free condition. We know that problem freeness is there. And we know it's close, and we just feel just need something. And the intellect tells us, well, we just have to solve a problem somehow. And we do that problem freeness. So what I felt was that I am and we are the world one song away from bliss and no more problems, world peace, utopia. One song away. And I heard the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson's song, I Get Around. I heard that song, I said, wow, that's very close. That's almost it, maybe it's it. And there's something about like that sound that they had going there. So being tuned into that and listening to the radio, I kept listening to the radio, said, okay, where's that song? And you hear this, so that's almost it, I Get Around. Oh, that's almost it, that's how I felt. Oh my gosh, that's almost it. And being a musician in previous lives, a very good one, I felt like I can hear it. I'm going to hear it. That's it. I'm going to bliss. And then I didn't get it. I said, maybe I need to write that song. Maybe I can help participate either in a band or recording or do something to make that one song and bring that one song, to birth that one song into the world. And when it's birthed into the world, that'll solve everybody's problems, because when everybody hears that song, they will simply go into bliss. And so then I started listening to the radio. When's it could come? The Beatles, and I said, oh my gosh, this might be it. And so we listened constantly. When is the next Beatles record coming out? When's the next Beatles record? We got to hear it. Had a transistor radio at school. I was constantly listening to transistor radio. We all had transistors, people. After work, after school, we go listen to the records, go to the record store. Always hanging out in the record store. Got to get the 45. Got to get the single. Got to get the single. You know, who is it? Jan and Dean or some sound that's just like fun. I can hear music. I can hear music by the Beach Boys. I can hear music. We're hearing this music, and then we're showing this culture on television. We're saying, we are super close to permanent happiness. Super close. Just where is this artist who's going to come into the world and is going to say, okay, here's the song, here it is for you. I said, well, I better do my part. I better start practicing. So I started practicing guitar 8 to 10 hours a day, actually, just like a crazy person. I had to learn how to play all this music, because I felt maybe I can produce this song. Maybe if I get the right inspiration. So what Brian Wilson was trying to do, and many others, was get the right inspiration. They're just looking for that breakthrough. And started taking all sorts of drugs to get that creative breakthrough. They felt this is worth it. I know it. We're close. I used to go down and visit relatives in LA area, and it was just incredible. The magnolias were blooming, the gardenias were blooming, the sprinklers were on the grass, the lawns were lush, and you felt this vibe there in the atmosphere. It's just like, wow, what a place. Los Angeles in the 60s, that area, the suburban areas, and you just felt like something's going to happen here. Something great is going to happen. And so we expected it. And then the Beatles came. We said, well, wait a minute. Maybe it's coming from Liverpool. Maybe it's coming from England. And we tuned into that. And all the English groups on the coattails of the Beatles. There's so many. So I got hooked into it by saying, listen, maybe we are really close. Maybe, therefore, I really should make a huge effort to produce that song somehow. And I felt guilty. If I didn't do it, I might be depriving the world of something important. If I didn't make at least try my very best. I tried my very best, and then that hooked me into everything else and caused a disaster after disaster after disaster. So it's not that we're one song away. It's actually we're one choice away. And the music doesn't choose for us. We think the music is going to inspire the choice. It doesn't. Okay, this is very important now. We're getting to something very important. Music does not inspire the choice. What inspires it is seeing. Clarity inspires it. Actually feeling enough courage and enough lessening of fear to look and see what this world actually is, what's really going on here. That's what brings about that one step, that choice. It's not music. And what we do in this world is so many try to be inspired through art, to think the art is going to inspire them to get somewhere. Does not. I was listening to maybe the best female singer I've ever heard, really, singing this incredible song. And I said, well, that's really great singing. But then was I inspired to the... And just before I was having this realization and seeing everything, did this inspire me to that? No, it didn't. In fact, it detracted from it. It detracted from it. It was saying, hey, maybe this is sufficient. Maybe if we just get this go-go vibe going, and there's whooping and the hollering and everybody clapping and everyone clapping and yeah, everyone cheers, yeah. Cheers the performance. Yeah, it's a great performance. Yeah. We're all revved up. That's so neat. That's great. Love you. Love it. We feel like, okay, that should inspire us. It is not. That does not inspire the one choice to accept the overlay and recognize that I've never had any problems. Never had any real problems. So in other words, what we're doing with music is we're saying the problem is real, but there's a way to cure it. There's a pill. There's a song. The song's like a pill. There's this pill you can take. There's a song you can listen to, and it's going to cure your problems. Well, I've listened to a million songs, and probably more than that, and it doesn't cure. It doesn't cure it at all. Does not cure. It's like taking an aspirin for a headache or something. Like, say you have a permanent headache, you take an aspirin, maybe it knocks it out. You feel kind of like dully, like it's not so bad, and then it comes back. It's like when you eat a ghost pepper and then you drink some milk and it puts out the fire for like 10 seconds and you say, oh, gosh, that's so bad now. And then comes back on you. You say, oh my gosh, I'm back. The furnace has been reignited. Oh God, what do I do? Drink some more milk. And you keep trying to drink that milk to keep that fire down, but it's still there, and it just doesn't really do the job at all. The suffering is still there. So music is like drinking milk. It cuts the fire of capsaicin, but it doesn't put the fire out. And music does not solve anything. It wastes your time, actually. It gives you false hope. And musicians and producers, they're really drug pushers. They're pushing false hope is what they're doing. So many musicians are into drugs because they're trying to find that ultimate song. They're trying to find it. And that's why I'd have all these jam sessions. I was trying to find this ultimate riff, this ultimate groove, this ultimate song. And I'd play, you know, 8 hours. I'd just go on and on and on until my fingers were just so painful I couldn't even play anymore. And I just did that over and over and over and over and over, constantly jamming, constantly looking for what is this song? I know there's got to be a song somewhere that is going to work somehow. It's going to free us from suffering. That's what musicians are trying to do. Hey, let me see if I can free the audience. And so you try to give a great performance, a great performance. And I listen to all these great performers saying, how can I incorporate that in, you know, somehow? Or can I distribute the music? Can I help? I used to have all these songs. I try to get people to listen to them. Say, listen to this, listen to this, listen to this. You're really going to like this song. So I was a big time one of those people who I ran the high school music center at lunchtime and played all these records. I tried to get people, come on, listen to this, listen to this, listen to this. This is going to help you. Of course, everyone has a different taste in music, and they said, oh, I don't like that. That's not my thing. It's like you want to try to have a breakthrough, and some of the songs seem to like build up to, you know, we're going to have a breakthrough. We're gonna somehow start floating in the air. If we just elevate, let's elevate, let's get ride this groove, let's ride this groove. And of course, what happened? No one really elevates at all. And then to keep pushing that kind of excitement, people take drugs, stimulants, all sorts of stuff to try and still get out there and deliver that hope. They're delivering hope, but it's a false hope. It's a false hope. It's under the guidance of the intellect. It's the intellect that's doing that, actually. The intellect is actually doing everything in this world. This is all the play of the intellect, is all it is. What we are is not engaged in this world at all. Not engaged with it whatsoever. It's the intellect doing all of it. All of it. That's what I saw. Everything I've been doing in this world is simply the play of the intellect. But I thought I was doing something. I thought I'm doing something important. No, it's not true. I spent time, so much time, when I wasn't studying like A Course in Miracles, I was listening to the radio, an oldie station. I had a guitar, and I was learning how to play sing and play every song. I learned hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. I used to be able to play every single Beatles song that there was. Every single one. Every single Beach Boys song. Most of the Motown songs I could play. I know how to play and sing all of those songs. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. It was like a human jukebox. I was thinking, if I could just give enough emotion and sing this song perfect, there'll be an epiphany. People have an epiphany. And I just, somehow this epiphany will cause a breakthrough of realization that all we need is this song. All we need is this song. But that's not true. The realization that you're problem-free is beyond a song. It is greater. What we need is greater than a song, by far, immeasurably so. What we realize is we are problem-free, we've never had a problem, and we never can have a problem. We literally are untouchable by problems, untouchable. And we're totally innocent of all problems. The innocence, we talk about, we're super innocent. We're innocent of problems. We talk about children being innocent. What they mean, they're innocent of all the problems of the world because they haven't yet, you know, this hasn't impinged upon them so much. But that's just a metaphor. What we really are is totally innocent of problems. Not because it's young, because it doesn't have any problems. It's that type of innocence. We get confused trying to use metaphors that only are pointers. They're only pointers. It is not the same as innocence of children. Not at all. Not even close to that. I know Jesus said you must be as little children, but that's just a metaphor. And you have to go beyond metaphors. Metaphors merely are like a pointer pointing somewhere, but what they're pointing to is beyond the metaphor, what the metaphor can convey. The innocence is the innocence of simply cannot be touched by these, and there's not like it's learned to avoid it or defend against it. No, there's not even the slightest recognition of any problems at all. There's not a denial of problems. It just simply is the problem-free. Reality is totally problem-free. And so the true self is that pure innocence, that quality is something we cannot generate in this world, not through any music, not through anything, because all that does is dull down our problems. Of course, we in this world as a body, mind, we have all these problems, and we listen to a song, we still have all the problems of a body, mind. It's just we're trying to dull it down or forget about it. But forgetting about problems is totally different than not ever having any problems. Totally different. Our self has never had a problem. And we can literally allow that feeling to be with us, that presence to be with us. We just have to accept it, invite it in. And accept that here is that which has never had a problem and never will. And how does that feel? How does that feel? So everything we're doing in the world is to try and compensate for the problems we're having. Try to put band-aids, heal the wound. But what we truly are has never had a wound, never had a problem. And we are still that, and always will be that. Now, is it possible to experience this here? Absolutely, it is possible. And we need to do that. And so that's what the focus is. The quality is unmistakable, that those who have allowed this presence of the true self, accepted it here into the body mind to dwell with the body mind here, the quality that is there is noticeably different. It's unmistakable. Because it's not like here's somebody who's learned to solve problems. Here's someone that has at some point in the past solved their problems. It's not some master or spiritual master who knows how to solve problems or get free of these problems. No, it's the literal presence of that which has never had a problem and knows that they never can. They don't even know what a problem is. They couldn't possibly even know. In reality, there's no such thing as a problem. It's not even something that could even be understood at all. It's not understandable. Problems are not understandable. Only in a hypothetical scenario can problems seem to be understandable. But reality has no understanding of problems or anything like that. Now, the Prime Creator knows that we have something hypothetical scenario that we are attached to, so provides the overlay for that. But there's no problem for the Prime Creator. It's not looked at as a problem. It is looked at in a pragmatic sense of continuity and attachment that we have. But it's not acknowledged that we have problems. We don't. The body mind has problems, of course, but they're not the problems of our identity or what we are of reality at all. And the body mind does not have to be problematic to us. Does not have to be. That's why you have Ramana Maharshi dying of some kind of throat cancer, and he said it's not problematic to me. It's just the body mind is going towards dissolution, but it's not the slightest problem to what I am. I don't experience it as a problem at all. And people thought, well, maybe he's using some kind of power to kill the pain or anything. No, he's not. Not at all. Nothing like that. It's not like that. It's not like that at all. It's that the awareness of the body mind is so distant, like a faint shadow. That what concern do you have about what the body mind is going through as far as an illness or something? None. He's not feeling it. He's not experiencing it. It's like you look up at the night sky and you see some faint distant star. Are you like, obsessed with, with that faint distant star and what's going on with that star, etc., etc. No, not at all. It's the most irrelevant, distant to you. So we have not yet seen this, the full significance of this situation. And not many have, but we're closing in on it. It's more profound than we expect, perhaps. But actually, the little insights, the little mini epiphanies, get you ready, get you used to it. So I say, okay, I was having these epiphanies the last couple of days, and I was just saying, okay, I see all this. Everything I've done has just been trying to pretend to be problem-free. That's what the intellect does. That's what we do here. That's what belief does. We try to put on an image like, hey, I'm problem-free. I don't have any problems. Look at me. And look where I am. Look what I'm doing. I'm problem-free. That's what we do. We try what I'm doing is going to result in being problem-free. And again, we say, well, if we're in a problem-free, accept our problem-freeness, the body's going to die because we won't go try to get food for it, etc. And like I have said, if you really accept that you've never had a problem, then literally the body becomes nourished inherently without any food. No food is even necessary at that point. That you can absorb the essence of around you into the body, actually. So the idea that we're all become sick, well, that is not true. It is not true at all. Because Ananda Maimonides said she didn't need to eat. She didn't need to eat at all. And they said, how can you go on one grain of rice a day for, you know, months at a time? And how can you not drink anything? It's crazy. It's impossible. She goes, no, I'm simply pulled. This body just pulls the nourishment in essence-wise from the atmosphere, from the environment, whatever it needs, it actually just pulls it in. Because this is all really a mirage anyway, it's all a dream. So you just pull in dream nourishment. And she said, I don't really need to eat at all. But I do so for your sakes because sometimes you like to see me eat. Sometimes you get freaked out that I'm not eating. So, okay. And then there are other times when everybody insisted that she eat. They said, you're too skinny, you're too skinny. We want you to be plump. We want you to eat. And she'd go, okay. So what she'd do is she'd start eating, and she wouldn't stop. And she'd consume incredible quantities of food, enough for a huge group of people. And she'd just keep eating like that. And people say, my God, what are you doing? Stop. She said, no, you told me that just you want me to eat and gain weight, so I'm just eating. And didn't affect her adversely at all. They said, how's that possible? It's not possible to eat that much. See, when it's realized that the body is simply more, all this is a pretense, it's all imagination, it's all a dream, it's all a mirage, it's all a hallucination, then those type of things can happen without any effect. But don't try to do those things from the standpoint of the intellect, because you'll kill yourself if you do stuff like that. Obviously, don't try to fast on no food, you'll kill yourself, because you keep thinking that the problems are real, but you're trying to overcome the problems. So you're not coming from the standpoint of recognizing this is all just a hallucination. Don't try and put the cart before the horse and do things backwards. You'll only hurt yourself. Which the intellect does, it tries to mimic those who have awakened from the dream. Try to say, oh, I can do that, or I can do that. And they try to force the issue, not realizing that those who have awakened know that what they are doesn't have any problems, and they never will, and this whole idea of problems is just a complete pretense imagination. So from that standpoint, they can imagine whatever's necessary for the viability of their communication device, their body. They can even travel, bilocate, they can travel someplace instantly if they want to. But it's not done through any technique or anything like that. It's just from a realization that they're in a dream, there are no real laws. They're not absolutes. In a dream, you dream whatever you want to dream. We've got some consensual, we dream in a consensual way, sort of. But you can walk on water if you want to. But don't try it, because again, you don't realize that everything's a hallucination. And you're not free of that. So of course, you'll fall into the water. Or don't walk on the hot coals. I mean, some people can do it because there's a various insulating properties of the feet and the situation, temperature, inversion, various things. You can walk across coal pits and other people have problems with it. It's stupid to do that stuff. It's stupid to show off like that you have some superpowers or psychic powers, all that stuff. It's nonsense. That's not the goal at all. Anandamayi Ma was in a satsang, giving satsang, darshan, viewing, and someone later, months later, came to the place where she was staying, and the people, and they said, "Oh, thank you so much. My God, I was in a horrible situation, and I was going to die, or I was going to kill myself, or some terrible thing, and you showed up for me, and you comforted me, and I want to thank you for that. I don't know where you went after that, but I've been trying to find you." And people say, "What day was that? What time was it?" And they said, "Well, it's this date and this time." They said, "That's not possible. She was here with us giving the satsang. How could she travel over 1,000 miles? That's not possible. She was here the whole time. And this is 1,000 miles away." And the person would say, No. It was the flesh and blood was here helping me. And we had a great visit and a great talk. And it was just completely real." And they say, "Well, what's going on?" By location. Theoretically, someone who's truly awakened from the dream and realize they have no problems can bilocate. And there's no limit to it. They can appear in an infinite number of places at the same time, if necessary, if that's what is helpful. They can two places, three places, four places, five places. There's no limit to it. No limit to it whatsoever. They can also produce food, like Jesus feeding the bread and loaves. They can literally, simply produce food out of thin air, as it were, infinitely, without the slightest problem. It's the same way like you're in a dream. Let's say you have lucid dream, you know you're dreaming. You say, "Wait a minute, I don't like this landscape. Let me just slide this to the side, and here's a whole new landscape. This is what I want." Just like that. You can literally produce a whole new world in your dream, right? Instantly, you decide, "I don't want this dream world. I'm gonna dream another world." There it is. It's the same thing. There's no difference. There's absolutely no difference to one who's truly awakened, who knows this whole world is nothing but a dream. So, again, Jesus, easy. Fish and bread. For everybody, 10,000, 100,000, doesn't matter how many people, never run out, never just keep pulling out of the basket. They're just always multiply like that. Because it's simply the grace of God in the dream saying, "This is helpful, so let us do this. People call those miracles, etc., but in your dream every night you do that all the time. You decide, "I don't want this dream, let's shift over here," and boom, you shift. My dreams are incredibly rich and detailed and realistic and unbelievable. I mean, I walked in a dream recently, I walked into this massive bookstore, and there were these magazine racks, and there were thousands of different types of magazines, and I could see the cover of every single one in the writing, and they were all magazines I've never seen before in the world. Different titles, different pictures. Detailed, thousands, stacks and stacks, racks and racks, and then all the books in the bookstore. I could see every single book with different titles. It's just incredible, unbelievable, how detailed my dreams can be. And I could open the magazine, and there's articles and everything in a dream. Super detailed. It can be anything. I can dream of anything. Anything at all, oceans, landscape, everything is completely detailed. So how is that any different than looking at this world? It's not any different, really. And the fact is, this world is a hallucination, just like a dream is a hallucination. It's a spiritual hallucination. It's not the body-mind that's hallucinating. It's a spiritual hallucination. It's spirit saying, I want problems. Well, there aren't any problems in reality. So what is, if spirit wants problems, what does it have to do? It has to hallucinate. Hallucination is like you're seeing something that's not really there. It's like you're seeing pink elephants or something floating in the sky. You know, they're not there, but you can, when you go into a reverie, you can imagine that you're seeing all this stuff there that's not there, as it were. But actually, this world itself is a hallucination. Existence is a hallucination. The universe is a hallucination. So, of course, one that is perfectly aware of this, they can, if necessary, produce hallucinations if it goes along the line of grace and your own salvation and saving you time. They can produce hallucinations too. They can hallucinate a whole world, easy, totally detailed too. Every last speck of grain of grass on a world, they can imagine that. They can hallucinate that. Or 100 worlds, or 1,000, or 1,000,000, or 1,000,000,000, whatever. They can hallucinate a house. They can hallucinate food, transportation, anything at all. It was said by someone who was traveling with a group of ascended masters or realized beings, that they literally manifested a massive palace and told this one to go in the palace and stay there for a while. And they went in there and it was absolutely exquisite, dripping with jewels. It was real, it was tall, tangible, solid. It's an incredible palace with beautiful diamonds and rubies and sapphires and emeralds and the most exquisite inlays of turquoise and, you know, you name it. And this disciple spent time in there like a king or so, or prince, and then he came out and said, you know, this really isn't it for me. And they said, okay, you're kind of free of that attachment. And he said, yeah, no, this isn't it, because I still have all the problems of living in the world, right? So even if you live in a palace like this in the world, you still have all these problems. What is that? That's not realization. And he said, okay. He left the palace, and then palace disappeared. And it wasn't like he just was in meditation and dreaming this. No, he was actually literally seeing the palace. He was in the palace. Everything was 100% realistic from his standpoint. So we wonder, how are we going to survive if we go on the path of recognizing we don't have any problems? Well, there are certainly those who realize our situation, that we may not be completely there yet. So they can literally manifest whatever it takes, whatever is necessary. That is certainly a possibility. Now, I don't know how helpful that would be, because some of us might react to that in a crazy way, thinking, oh, what is the secret? If I can learn to do this, I can manifest all these diamonds. And I mean, a true one who's truly realized, they can manifest diamonds, gold, anything you want. Just poof, and you have a whole handful of perfect diamonds, and then also you just poof. I mean, what would I do if I had a handful of diamonds? I'd probably look at them, say it's nice, and I'd probably say, okay, what's next? Forget it. Give me something else, and let's get through this. Hurry up. Come on. That's how I feel, but most people would say, oh my gosh, I've got $1 billion in my hands. And look at all the jewelry I can make with these diamonds. And look, and if I could figure out how to manufacture like this, I could be the diamond queen. And I could have all the diamonds in the world. I could just be super rich and powerful and have palaces and servants and everything. If I could just, you know, can I get some more? You can see how it's a big problem. Or if you have all this food manifest, you say, I can feed the whole world. I can just try to find a way to distribute this. And of course, people would say, well, where are you getting the food? And you say, well, no, it's just appearing. They'll say, whoa, we don't want anything to do with this. You're crazy. This is insane. And maybe it'll disappear on us. And all sorts of problems arise. So you may wonder, why do these realized beings, why don't they manifest stuff for us? Because it can become extremely problematic. I've never had anything manifested for me. Not that it, I know that it could be, but it's never happened. Although I have had subtle manifestations, like songs, various things that are like better than any song I've ever heard in the world. There's another problem. I had some singers in a dream that I thought were two enlightened gurus, two enlightened masters, and they were singing, and they asked me to sing with them. And the songs were so incredible, so beautiful. I said, wow, I want to dedicate my life to singing this music. And I thought they were going to come into the world and we would go around singing. Because in the dream, I was hearing this music. How they sang was so superior to how we sing. It was amazing. But now looking back, I say, hey, that was the intellect. That was delusion. That was misdirection. What a misdirection that was. Horrible. Horrible misdirection. I ended up wasting a vast amount of time and money and effort and getting myself into extremely bad situations because I was so sure that we were going to have go around the world singing together. But I saw these two beings in a dream crystal clear. I thought I recognized who they were. Thought they were perfectly realized masters beings. And then they were singing in harmony, and I was able to join in and sing with them. And from that point, I started practicing how to sing constantly. When I was driving for years and years and years, I practiced singing every day constantly, thinking I was going to be singing with them because I heard how this way they sang, and it was so incredible. I said, if people can just hear this singing, it'll save the world. That's how incredible it was. But now I have a different viewpoint. I found out how it's possible to sing better than the singing in the world that has today. But that doesn't bring enlightenment. Not at all. Not at all. It just brings another form of entertainment, another form of distraction, actually. But being a musician and being a lover of music, I bought into the belief that the music can save the world. And so you have these super singers. I thought these super singers could save the world. That they would attract people to truth, sort of. But what happens is when you hear this song, you get attracted to the song, to the music. You're not really being attracted to the truth. I thought that if we just sing this beautiful music, people would come and then they go to come to satsang and listen to the music, and they would then start being attracted to truth. No, they're being attracted to the music. And when you start talking, blah, 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 they say, I want to hear the song again. So why don't you sing some more? Like that. That's how it actually goes. Those who are attracted to truth are not attracted through music or anything. They're attracted through glimpses of freedom, and then to clarifying the clarity of it. How can they get that clarity? And they realize they must practice seeing, contemplation, consideration. They must spend the time in quiet focus. You can't be grooving to some song. No way. So who were those beings that showed up in my dream with that? Well, deception, high deception. Really, the deception that we run up against can be very high deception. It can produce stuff that for us seems like out of this world, so beautiful. And we think that if we just get this anchor, this beauty in the world, that will save us. It will not. The overlay saves us. That music was not an overlay. Was not the overlay. And of course, we can say, well, it'll attract us to the overlay. But the danger is that it'll be seen as a substitute for it. Really as a substitute for it. And even at this point in time, I listen to a really great song. It interferes with the clarity. Interferes with it. Takes its place. And you think, this is good enough. This is what I need. This is good enough. I don't need the overlay. That's what happens. It's a substitute. Now, could I sing with some super singers? Absolutely. But I try not to practice and get into that anymore. It's still tempting. You know, could you imagine some super musicians, super singers that are like the best in the world? My temptation would be to get up there and play and sing with them. But I could do it. But I'm trying to get away from that. Say no, forget it. And at this time, I might even say no. Even if there was such a situation, I'd probably say no. Not gonna do it. Of course, if they were that great singers, musicians, they'd become super famous. Super famous. And then you think, well, they can use that fame then to turn everyone to truth. It doesn't work that way. It never has. And never will. What happens is you get a cult from that situation. And you get people demanding and expecting. And they think, you got to give it to me. You got something you can give to me. It's not something that they're going to choose for themselves within. It's something that they feel someone can give to them. Some product that they'll make them a pill. A music pill that will save them. And so it almost amplifies delusion. What's more helpful, I'm seeing, is simple talk like this, simple pointing, which might seem boring to a lot of people, but that is actually more helpful. More helpful. There can be a certain amount of pomp and circumstance, but it has to be done in the right context. And you're probably best to leave sing aside. Although Anandamayi Ma was a great champion of singing as far as religious songs, but those were call and response songs of our meditative type of songs. It's different than what we think of as entertainment. It was not for the purposes of entertainment at all. It was for a purpose of blocking out entertainment, blocking out the world, of tuning in to the necessity for focus. But then at some point you have to go drop that, go beyond music. But I don't know, she talked about the sound, how the sound repetition over and over can somehow lead to salvation. So I imagine there must be some way to that, but it's a different situation we're talking about here. Singing would be the beauty of the human voice, and we'd say, oh, look what the body is capable of, look what the body mind is capable of, and it would reestablish this intent to get the most potential. It would reestablish, reamplify the path of human potential, which is the great adversary of realization, is the path of human potential. People on those who've engaged with the human potential movement are going down a wrong path, really, have been, and leading the world down a very wrong path. Because the overlay, there is no human potential that can bring about the overlay at all. Overlay the entire universe perfectly from all time, all space, all situations, everything could possibly arise, has arisen, will ever arise, eternally overlaid, and the realization that you've never had any problems at all. How can human potential bring that about? It cannot. It cannot. And so to give people hope in human potential is really a waste of time, big time waste of time. And those who've done that, you have to realize that and say, hey, this has been a waste of my time. That's what happens on when you want to make progress on the spiritual path. You do have to recognize you've been wasting time. And I have been recognizing that more and more. Like, wow, everything I've been doing is like a waste of time. I'm just wasting my time. And say, good, I see that. It's not a downer. It's not depressing. I say, that's great. Now I won't keep wasting it. If you don't realize it's a waste of time, you'll keep on wasting it. So clarity is really seeing, oh, I've been wasting my time. Oh, this doesn't work. That's what you want to see. Because you say, oh, I'm not going to do that anymore. That's a waste of time. And so you detach from those things, and then it's super helpful. You stop wasting time so much. Become more willing to see what actually works. So I can say, yeah, it's just all a waste of time. Even these videos, I could see it. Like, oh, it's just a waste of time. But what happens is it generalizes, and you see all of existence has been a waste of time. It's just not about you. It's everything in existence is a waste of time. It's totally a waste of time. The totality of it is nothing but a waste of time. Has no meaning, no purpose, nothing. It's just nothing. It's not just you. The realization isn't that I'm a waste of what I've been doing. It's everything is a waste of time. And so I saw this fabulous singer, heard this fabulous singer. I had to realize, oh, this is, she just wasted her time too, or wasted her life too. Didn't matter. She was belting out, had a real flexible voice and belting out songs. It doesn't matter. It's still a waste of time. Entertaining people like that is a waste of time. And don't waste your time like that. And so I'm just saying, you have to have that realization. I have to look back on all the music I produced and everything I did. It was a waste of time. It was a way I was being deceived. And then we try to make, say, well, let me see, find some way to use it that is helpful or something. And you really cannot, because what is really helpful here is experiencing the overlay, is experiencing the presence of the problem-free presence. That is what's really helpful here, truly helpful. And you have to keep realizing the other stuff is not truly helpful. It has too many downsides to it. You might be able to find some facets of it that you could say is helpful, but if you're taking one step forward and two steps back, that's not helpful. And we only look at the one step forward and we say, well, I'm taking a step forward here. And that's what I see in the world, is people, you try to alert them to this and they say, what do you mean? I'm making progress. I say, how's that? I'm taking a step forward, this little step, another step. And I say, yeah, but for every step forward you're taking two back. Going two back, or at least one back, so you're not getting anywhere. And they say, what are you talking about? Why are you so negative? Why are you so negative? Yeah. How is it negative if somebody is taking one step forward and two steps back to point that out to them and saying, it's not working for you, you're not making real progress? Why is that negative? Why do people say that's negative? That's super helpful. But some say, well, you're just a total downer. You're too negative. I don't like it. It's too negative. I'm saying, look, you need to actually make progress in terms of realizing that you don't, to accepting the presence of the problem-free self, which is the only self there is. Realize there is no self in the universe. Realize that this effort to solve problems is delusional. How are you going to get there if you take one step forward and two steps back? And they say, no, I'm making progress. You don't know what you're talking about. So what do you do there, you see? that's delusion. And most people live their lives in total delusion, their whole lives. Their entire lives is in delusion. And at some point, they have another life, another, and they finally realize they're not getting anywhere. And then they start saying, why am I not getting anywhere? I thought I was making progress, and all I'm getting is worse and worse situations. Because it gets worse. Existence gets worse. It can get way worse than what people realize. It can get intolerable, actually. And to those that it's become intolerable, they're actually in a good situation. Because they say, hey, wait a minute, I thought I was making all this progress, and now it's become intolerable. What is going on? They start asking questions. You start asking real questions. And if you're suffering bad enough, you're going to start asking real questions. Say, wait a minute, I want to have some answers here, and I'm not getting answers. Why am I not getting answers? Maybe I'm asking the wrong questions. Maybe I'm addressing the questions in the wrong place. Maybe, and you start really delving into the situation. Because you say, I can't go on their day like this. There's no way. Then you start making real progress. Then it's more than two steps forward, one step back. You start actually making real progress towards realization. And others are saying, no, they say, hey, this is still working for me. I'm still making progress, one step forward. And as far as the two steps back, let's not talk about that. Let's not worry about that. That's negative. I don't want to be negative. I don't want to think about that. But it's obvious. You know, like I said, the world is actually getting worse, not better. This is a classic example. The world right now is an absolutely classic example of what's being said here. Is we assume that we're really advancing because we're taking all these steps forward. What we don't see is for every step forward we've been taking with this modern world, the whole high-tech revolution, et cetera, we're taking multiple steps backwards. Multiple. One step forward, maybe four steps back. You know, we're actually losing ground to an extreme extent. But the scope of forward steps is so large that we assume that the backward steps couldn't be that many, couldn't be that bad. Huge assumption. Terrible assumption to make. That's how we fool ourselves. In other words, we think if the progress is rapid enough, it won't give any time to have backward steps. So let's just go really fast. Run. it's like we're on a treadmill, and we're on a treadmill, and this treadmill, like a conveyor, one of these conveyor belts at a airport. Okay, those long walk conveyor walkways. You get on those, and it gradually. Now, let's say you get on one going the wrong direction, and I've tried that sometimes, and you try to walk real fast, so you actually make progress. But if you stop walking fast, you start going backwards on this, right? So what we're doing is we're deciding, instead of walking real fast in the wrong direction on this conveyor belt, we're going to run. We're running real fast. We think, okay, if we just run real fast, we're going to definitely make progress and get to the end of this conveyor belt. But we don't realize that as we start running fast, the conveyor belt actually speeds up, and we're actually going backwards really fast. But we're so focused on running fast and ahead, we don't look around to the walls, you know, the airport. We don't see, oh my gosh, we are actually going backwards, because we see on the conveyor belt, if we just look at our feet, run like this, we say, oh my gosh, I'm picking them up and putting them down really fast. And they say, I must be making fast progress, because your tunnel vision is only at your feet on the belt, and you say, I'm running fast. But if you were to take your perspective off of your feet and look at the surroundings, you'd be see you're going backwards very fast. That's what you'd see. And people are in this cult in this world. This world's like really gone into a cult status. And they say nobody's supposed to look around and see what's going on. They're supposed to just focus on the feet. Faster. When's the next gadget being unveiled? And let's get it as fast as we can. Let's you know, it's like the people with smartphones, they go on lunch break. What do? I look at them. I used to talk with people, like I see people lunch break, and I just, hey, how's it going, you know, and what's up with this and this and that, how are the Giants doing, blah, 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 you know, and talking, yeah, there's some, you know, just quick interplay, communication, some feedback this way, we expand a little bit. Now, guys are on break. Everyone, not just, they're all completely, their whole focus is right on this little, you know, three square inches, and they don't see anything other than that. That is all they're aware of. It's like they're hypnotized by it, and you talk to them, they don't even hear you. They're so busy playing games, running apps, texting, etc., etc. All of them are doing that. The younger ones, the ones that I see, they're all on that. It's just, and the whole lunch break, every day now, their whole life is so focused there. They're not looking around the big picture. That's an example. Is the whole world, as it were, is like hypnotized, and their attention is so narrowly focused now. They don't see the big picture. And they're on this conveyor belt, focused on their smartphone, running as fast as they can. They're not looking up to see, wait a minute, we're going backwards at an extremely fast pace. We're losing ground. This is terrible. Must be a better way. The better way is to realize we don't need to get anywhere. We're already home. We've never left home. We're having this body mind do all this stuff to try and get home. We don't need to that. We're already home. We've always been, never left home. So what do we need all this effort here in the world for? Why do we need to get somewhere? Do something. Fix problems. We don't. There's no problems in our home. We don't have any problems to fix. Again, this is a hypothetical scenario based on the belief that we will have problems in reality. And so we're working on these problems ahead of time. That's all this world is. That's why I say it's a hallucination. It's a dream. It's imaginary. It's hypothetical. So in this hypothetical, do we really need to get anywhere? No, we don't. The more we believe we need to get somewhere, the more deluded we become. That's why I say in today's day and age, we're actually regressing. We're not progressing, but regressing, very rapidly regressing into a very dark place where literally those who feel that they know how to progress faster will call those in the world out who don't share, who are not willing to go along with their guidance or advice and the way they want to set up things. They want to set the world up in a certain way which will supposedly produce rapid getting somewhere progress. And those who are not willing to go along with that, they want to them to leave the planet, be gone, one way or the other. But from their standpoint, they want everybody to commit suicide who is not going along with their program, because they don't want to waste the time gassing everybody like the Nazis did. That's too much work and effort. What they really want is what I have been getting and seeing is they want people to commit suicide, those who are not willing to go along with this program of super rapid progress. They want them to commit suicide. Really, and the call has actually been going out now. The November 26th, I felt that there was this very strong push from subtle levels of this whole, the subtle levels of the intellect of belief, is to say, if you, what's your final decision? You don't want to go along with this? Okay, we had to have a final decision by this time, November 26th, 2012, and if you decided not to go along with this program of configuring this world in such a manner that everybody will be locked in to a super narrow viewpoint of rapid progress and always, if you're not willing to go along with that, then we are demanding that you vacate your body. That was November 26, 2012, and I felt it. I felt this incredible pressure to vacate my body. I just said, what in the world, where's this coming from? What's going on here? And I started tracing it back. Where is this coming from? This is totally abnormal. This is not coming from me. Where is it coming from? And it's coming from the subtle levels of the intellect of belief, where there is this will now to everybody to get on the same page towards super rapid progress. Super delusion is what it is. Because the more rapid the progress is, the actually faster you're going backwards. You're going backwards really fast because you're going into the belief that we have, the more you try to solve problems, the more you believe there are problems, and the more rapidly you're trying to solve problems, the more you believe there's all these massive amount of problems that you're working on. The faster the computers are, the more data they need to crunch, you know, like that. And so the more you're into solving problems, the more problems you believe there are. And the problems multiply, so to speak. And you actually get worse and worse and worse. And then you keep blaming those who are not on the same page more and more and more. It's just like Nazi Germany and Hitler, those, it's exactly the similar situation we're in right now. It's actually, the parallels are amazing, shocking parallels right now. They felt they had the way to solve all the problems on the planet. They really did. They are very advanced in technology and chemistry and a lot of subtle sciences at that time. And they felt that they could solve the problems of the world. If they just became the super overlords of the world, they would then get everybody on the same page, all problems would be solved. And all they need to do is get rid of those who are in the way, who are interfering with this, who weren't getting along. And that's what they did. They tried to do, and that's what they did to a large extent. Whoever doesn't seem to be part of this, doesn't want to be part of it, okay, see you later. And the build-up to this is super similar to the build-up that's taking place right now, except we're not seeing it because it's vastly greater right now, exponentially greater right now. They're talking about that entire countries are having their entire data stream looked at, intercepted. Their entire data streams from entire countries and are being all intercepted and all stored and all culled through algorithms, etc. Whole countries and this will take place globally. The whole data streams of the entire planet will be run through interception and algorithms. All right, delivery from the mail. And that literally is on the verge of that happening. It could have already happened, as a matter of fact. It's all the data streaming up to satellites, etc. And there are those who are aware of this, and but it goes beyond that. Okay, I know that, like the Julian Assange is giving out information about this, saying, "Hey, this can happen." Well, that's accurate, and may have already happened. It could happen very soon, where everything we're doing electronically is being logged and into databases and being culled through by algorithms to determine who is willing to get with the program and who isn't, and they could very quickly determine in the whole globally who is with them and who is not, very quickly. But what is not being said is they have a way to transmit directives subtly, subconsciously. They have ways to global to give out global directives subconsciously, telepathically, as it were. They have technology to do that, and they're sending out technology now. They're using that to transmit a directive that those who decided they're not going along with the future, the program they have, to vacate their bodies. They literally are doing that. And you may say, "Well, that's paradigm. That's crazy." No, it's not. And there's some of you who know very well what I'm talking about. That the technologies of extraterrestrials and that have been brought here to this planet, the subtle technologies that they have, they've incorporated into this whole planetary situation now, is easily capable of doing that, of transmission of demands and directives on a global scale through subtle ways. Could be microwaves, I don't know. They can encode it. There's ways to encode it in waveforms that reach our brains, reach our consciousness, reach consciousness of the whole planet. And they can say, hey, if you have decided not to go along, then you must vacate your body right now, right now. That's what they're doing. That's what I felt November 26th. And I said, no, what is this? And I've been able to push it back. It hasn't come back. It's still, I can feel it's still there, but it's not getting a consent from me. It's not getting consent. It's still knocking on my door. Now the post person just delivered some package here to the door, and I'm taping right next to it here. And I just kept right on taping, and they didn't see me. And they just come in, deliver, and they go off their business. I don't have to engage them. I don't have to engage them at all. So I don't have to engage this demand. I don't have to explain to the demand why I don't want to vacate my body or anything like that. I just say, no, I'm not going to do that. And it'll say, well, if you just explain to me, I'll go away. No, it won't. Because then you get into conceptualization, and you get into part of your mind where you lose the will. You're not aware of the will that you have. And you get into words, and suddenly you feel like you're in quicksand, because words are subject to interpretation, and you feel you're not conveying your will properly through the words. And then you feel like you're all weak. So it's important to stay with your will and not get too wrapped up in words. I can use words here on these satsangs to some extent, because I've had a long practice with that. But still, it's a very dangerous thing. It's a very slippery slope. You're not careful. You will feel like you're losing touch with your will, which just says no. Will is the yes or no. And use your will and say, I choose this or I choose that. That's the will. This is what I choose. And say, no consent, no. That's it. That's the will. It says no. That's it. No doesn't mean yes. And it's a very clever thing that they've done. Really, the ETs and their associates here are very diabolically clever, actually. And I can see what they've done. And seeing more and more and more of it. And how it all ties in. And how they're trying to overcome your consent by trying to say that your yes really means no. Or your no means yes. Your no means yes. And this all ties in with, if I go down that road, we'll have a whole talk on how culture has been manipulated to turn things around towards those people who are most likely to say no, not give their consent, and try to make them feel guilty, like in the past they took a no to mean yes. So in order to make reparations, they need now their no to accept that their no to vacating their bodies really means yes. And trying to use guilt to force that. And the whole thing about feminism ties into that, absolutely ties into that. I see very clearly how it's been tied in to put the pressure of guilt on people. That the feminists will say, yeah, when we said no, you took our no to mean yes, and we didn't give our consent, you overrode our consent, you know, sort of tacit rape, so to speak. You know, they try to say it all encounters were really rape because we didn't really give our full consent, and so our the no's we were really meant, you thought that was yes, and so we consented to that, and therefore you're guilty of rape. And if you want to get free of that, the way to get free of that is to, when you say no consent to vacating your body, you have to say, well, that no really means yes, and you really have to go along with it. Very diabolical. And I've been aware of this the whole time. There's a super clever diabolical trick being used that is employing feminism to twist the consensual thing around, and at some point to make us feel guilty that we can make reparations for quote unquote previous consensual rape situations, which of course they can always say in retrospect, say, oh, you know, that encounter, actually I didn't really consent to that. It was really a rape, but I just didn't want to tell you at the time. And then you say, oh my gosh, I terrible, this rape, are you kidding? And they say, but I'll let you off the hook if you just consent to vacate your body right now. I say, but I don't want to. Well, they say, well, I didn't want to have that encounter. I said, no, but you took it as yes, so I'm going to take your no as yes too at this point and insist that you do it. And then you think, well, I got to get rid of this guilt. I did something terrible, you know. That's how it's being used, actually. Very clever. Very clever. And some will not see this. Some will see it. Some will intuitively say, you know, there's something to that. Which is why I always realized it's super important. To me, it was always super important to be very clear what the feminists were up to. Very clear. Because it didn't add up. The whole thing didn't add up. I said, they have some secret agenda going on. Very clearly. And I don't see the application of it. See, I couldn't see the application of it. Now I see the application of it very clearly. Because they've been promised pie in the sky by the extraterrestrials and their associates here. They've been promised that a utopia if they would just play along with it and allow themselves to be used in this way. They were promised a utopia. And of course, they weren't told what the application was either. They weren't told. They were deceived. I mean, the women of this world were deceived by the extraterrestrials. I knew they were being deceived, and I spoke up, and they wouldn't listen, of course. Because they were too... Their vanity was used against them. Because women have this weakness of vanity, as a fact. We all have our weaknesses, and those ETs exploit our weaknesses. And they said, you know what, you'll be a goddess. You'll be in a utopia. You'll have no more wrinkles. You won't age. All this stuff they're telling, they say, oh my gosh. And they said, what do we need to do? Just... start working this angle here about men and they say, but men deserve it anyway. I saw a commercial recently about a rat poison, killing rats. And the one that had the rat problem was a woman, and she said, and the one who played the rat was a man. He was in a rat suit and a man. And he was saying, he was laying all this stuff, talk on the woman. The woman saying, stood up to him finally, said, no, you know, here's how I'm going to deal with you. Meaning, give poison. And I noticed long ago, I noticed that in all the commercials that men were being portrayed a certain way, complete change. And it was always the woman that was portrayed in the positive light and always the man in a very bad light. And it's become more and more and more and more that way, nonstop. The grace of God told me, look at these commercials, what are you seeing? And I just watched and watched, and I said, well, I'm seeing that the man is always the idiot, the stupid guy, the bad guy, and the woman is always the heroine, the good person, the one who knows what's right, always. And so that's incredible. How is that possible that the people are not seeing this? Guilt, fear, guilt. And women saying, everything's okay, I'm leading you to an utopia, I've been promised utopia, I know how to get you there. But they weren't told the end game of how this is going to be used, which is guilt, which is to gain consent to vacate bodies for all those who are refusing to go along with this agenda, this ET agenda in this world. They weren't told that. They weren't told that. And there's a lot of women actually intuitively knew there's something wrong with this. It's bogus. And they said, no, this is bad. But many, they said, wait a minute. I want to be liberated, you know, I want to be able to travel everywhere, I want to have all these perks, I want to have all these clothes, and I want to be this fashion goddess, and I want to be, you know, super woman, and that's great. And they said, okay, let's go for it. That's not a big deal, because it's really going to help all the men. It's really going to help them. And this is the Adam and Eve story where the snake came to Eve and tempted Eve and she ate of the apple, and then that cast both of them into misery and suffering. It's the same principle, is that the ETs understand there's this vanity principle. If they approach it the right way and say, hey, look, you can live forever and you'll be beautiful forever. And you'll have all this beautiful ornamentation and clothes and home and transportation. You'll be able to travel everywhere. Everybody will look, will say, oh, how beautiful you are. And you'll be fresh and dewy and your skin. And then just on and on and on and on. And your children will be beautiful children. Your teeth will be perfect and genetically will fix all your problems and you won't get sick. And I once asked this woman who is actually quite wise, to some extent, very smart, super smart. And I said, well, if you had one wish, what would it be? And she said, I don't have wrinkles. It just kills me. She said, it just kills me. And here's someone who seemed to be beyond all vanity. And she was honest. And there's one quality that I appreciate. Honesty is the greatest quality there is in this world, the greatest. And she said, I just hate these wrinkles. I want to get rid of these wrinkles. I just can't stand that I'm getting wrinkles, and just bug the hell out of her. Imagine the ETs coming to her and saying, we have a way to get rid of these wrinkles. And they showed her some vision of what she'd look like without wrinkles. She goes, oh my God. And what do I have to do? And they said, just a little thing here. And just a little thing, just a little thing, just a little thing. Step by step by step, this agenda was put forth. And they weren't told what it's going to be used for, actually. And now I'm seeing exactly what it's being used for, which is a huge breakthrough, actually. Gigantic breakthrough here. It just happened just here in taping. I said, oh my gosh, it's being used to try and twist consent around. And for instance, when I say no, I don't give any consent to vacating my body, then that the guilt is trying to be used against me to say, well, your no really means yes. Remember, just like when supposedly you had consent, you know, for a sexual encounter or something, and that you thought it was a yes, but it was really a no, so it was really rape, so you're really a rapist, and you're going to be exposed as a rapist, and you'll be tried as a rapist, and your life's going to be ruined. But if you just consent to vacate your body and realize that your no really means a yes, we will call it even. That's being used like that, exactly what it's being used for. And of course, I know there are people out there, and deep down they're saying, aha, now we're seeing it. Now we're seeing it. But most have been knocked out. Most of the men who've struggled against this have been knocked out. Knocked out. Because they said this is going to be used against us at some point in a very wicked way, which is absolutely true. Absolutely true. Now we're seeing exactly how it's going to be used. Voila. And there was all these games being played. Women started playing all these games, these really weird games. I said, what the hell is going on here? I said, well, I'm giving consent, but I'm really not. I'm really saying yes, but are you sure I'm saying yes? And so it's just yes, yes, yes. And then later I said, well, it wasn't necessarily yes. It might have been a no. You don't really know. And so they've created this whole ambiguity, massive ambiguity, total ambiguity. And all the men are like freaking out, like, this ambiguity from women. I don't understand. It's really weird what's going on. It's purposeful. It's absolutely on purpose. Because there was an end game to it. And we're at the end game now. And that end game is to try and gain consent. Try to, through coercion, this coercion and fear of guilt and punishment, future punishment for men to say, okay, I'm going to vacate the body. That's exactly what's going on. Just 1 minute here. I didn't expect to come across this today. This was just unexpected. Which is why these thought songs are important, because you never know what's going to come up. It's the effort to clarify that suddenly gives rise to connecting the dots. 1 minute here. And this is a huge connection. This is a gigantic connection. It puts it all together. All the pieces of the puzzle suddenly fall into place. Because most certainly, over the last 40 years or so, the rise of feminism and the way that it arose and the way that it unfolded and everything. At first I thought, this is great. Women are taking responsibility for their own ideas and thoughts and reactions and their problems, their ego nature, and looking within and saying, hey, we got to do this ourselves. We can't have men do it for us. I said, that's fantastic. We're getting somewhere. And then it suddenly changed and it became something entirely different. I said, what is going on? Very strange, very strange. And it got worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And then suddenly there's this massive ambiguity arising. And there's this massive revisionism happening. That everything that's ever happened between men and women actually was never consensual. It was always coercion. Everything was coercion. It was all men that had coerced, instead of seeing as the intellect that's coercing everyone. You see, it suddenly became this deadly game, this deadly situation. I said, there's something very wicked at work here, very deadly. But it seems, you know, how's it playing out? We're looking. We don't quite see. How's it going to be used? What is this leverage? How's this massive leverage that women have supposedly, females, feminism supposedly has gotten this massive leverage over men now, to the point where men are being portrayed as rats, and their just desserts is rat poison, okay? Which is pretty similar to the Zyklon, Zyklon gas that was, what was it, for gophers or rats, and being the Germans used in their gas chambers. Zyklon B or something that poured this, maybe it was for ground squirrels or gophers or something. They put it down the holes and released this gas or something like that. That's what they use. So we're getting now advertised on television that's portraying men as being justified by women to gas them, as it were, to poison them. I just saw that. I said, well, here we go. This is the game is really on, isn't it? And the application is here now. I was able to beat back that, push back that demand, saying, no, I'm not going to vacate. But if you feeling all this guilt, like all the entire relationship you've ever had with women in all of history, all of existence, has been all coercive, all exploitive, all totally wicked in your standpoint. So how can I make amends? Well, they say, well, you can start by vacating your body. And that's what women want. See, these women are now saying, that's what we want you to do. We'll accept that as reparations to us. But who are they to be demanding and accepting reparations? You see, that's the question. They invented a crime, and now demanding payment for that imaginary crime. And the fact the whole thing was intentionally done in pretense and purposely. Not necessarily being aware of the end game, how it was going to be used, though. I don't think they were aware of that. They were simply being used by the ETs, and I saw that. I tried to explain to them, hey, you're being used, very badly used, and I'm not going to go along with whatever their agenda is. I'm not going to go along with it. I told them, hey, no way, no way. You're wasting your time. As far as I'm concerned, you're wasting your time with me, for sure. Because I know this is all a dance of pretense, and everything here is consensual, actually. Everything that's ever happened in existence has been consensual. No grounds for guilt whatsoever, as a fact. Because everything here is a hallucination. It's all a pretense. It's all based on us trying to solve problems, being presented with crises. We accept this scenario. We're the ones who are asking for this scenario to unfold, this dance to be danced. So how can what we truly are isn't being harmed at all? So how can what we truly are be demanding reparations? It cannot. How can, why should we, a dream figure demanding reparations of another dream figure? What purpose does that serve? It serves no purpose whatsoever. Guilt doesn't serve any real purpose whatsoever. Reparations serve no real purpose whatsoever. I know there's a big movement on beneath the surface for reparations for people, for races, etc., of past treatment of what. So there's no purpose as far as salvation goes, none. And those who suspect they're going to get reparations, they simply are waiting for that, which is a gigantic waste of their time. Super stupid to do that. Say, oh yeah, we're going to get reparations. They're coming, they're coming, they're coming. And of course, those who promise reparations then get elected. And they say, yeah, they're coming, they're coming, they're coming. And they're just waiting for reparations, which is incredibly stupid. They should be saying, well, wait a minute. What I am never suffered any problem at all. I don't need reparations. I'm perfect. I'm flawless. I'm problem-free. They should spend their time realizing that instead of waiting for reparations. And then, of course, they're projecting guilt on those supposedly who are supposed to provide the reparations. And they say, "Well, we'll get rid of it. Let you get free of this guilt if you make the reparations." You see how that works? This world is a super nasty place. The dynamics of existence are super nasty. And those who are not aware of that get caught up in this super nastiness. And now they're thinking, oh, I can get rid of this guilt I feel. I can make things right with women if I decide to vacate my body now, because that's what they want. Because they're saying, you're not on the same page. You're not on our agenda. You're not in the page of turning us into goddesses, perfect super women. And therefore, we do want you to vacate your body now. And we'll call all the guilt that you have in regard to us, we'll call it square, and at some other place in time, then we will have a loving relationship, blah, 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 like that. The loving relationships, we're not here to have loving relationships with people. We're here to realize we're problem-free, which is love itself. There's only love. There's not loving relationships. There's only love. There's one identity. There's one reality. There's one truth. There's one love. That's it. That's already true. So what happens is when we get pulled into the idea of loving relationships as though that's used to manipulate us, severely manipulate us. And someone can say, wait a minute. I thought the loving relationship was really coercive. In order to reestablish the love, you have to then make reparations to me. And the ETs exploit that. They've exploited that. It's a loophole, kind of. They're very shrewd. They've exploited that. Very wicked. Very, very wicked. So, I realized, what are you trying to establish loving relations with? That's ridiculous. I see all these so-called spiritual teachers in the world, what I see is they're desperately trying to make amends to women. They have all these women around them, and these women are just ruling them, really. And you can see that they're operating from guilt, and they're saying, I need to satisfy what these women want from me in order to make amends for something. Maybe I can make reparations for all men or something. They're just being manipulated. Being manipulated by their sanghas manipulating them. And we're supposed to wait on these gurus who are supposedly making reparations on our behalf? That is nonsense. No reparations, no guilt. There's absolutely none. But we cannot suffer problems. So how could our self be asking us to make reparations? It cannot possibly. It must be a delusional self, a hypothetical self, asking for reparations. And the answer to that is not that problems are real and big reparations for guilt, is that problems, there are no such thing as real problems. That is the answer. Not to try to fix problems, make them real and fix them. That's delusional. So I'm not trying to make anything up to anybody. There's nothing to make up. Everything that's happened, everything that happens in this world is a dance of imagination, is all intentionally done to try and generate certain leverage and results, etc., etc., etc. There are no real victims or real victimizers. There's none of that really at all. That's a delusion. But there are these nasty dynamics that try and give consent where we don't really want to. See, that is a cleverness. But that cleverness comes from our desire to be prime creator. So we're ultimately responsible for everything that happens here. We're ultimately responsible no one else is ultimately responsible for it, because it comes from our own desire to be prime creator, to change reality. Therefore, we consent to this hypothetical scenario. We consent to it. And once we consent to this hypothetical scenario, we don't realize that we're the dreamer of the dream. We think that this hypothetical scenario is the dreamer. And then, of course, we feel all sorts of, do bad things, get victimized, all this kind of stuff seems real to us. Seems real, but it's not. So maybe after this video, I'll say, what the heck did I say? Why did I say this stuff? That's nuts. As I'm asking for trouble or something. Not really, but it could feel that way. Yeah, after I make these videos, I feel like, wow, do I really want to say that? You know, that could really rattle some cages. It'll rattle, of course, the cage of the ETs. This is their whole game. This is really outing their game. The guilt, they're using the guilt from women to gain consent from mostly men, but also other women, whoever doesn't want to go with the agenda. They'll say, well, you're a sympathizer with men. For instance, if you're a woman, you say, I won't vacate my body, I don't want to go on, I'm not going along with this agenda, but I'm not going to vacate my body, no consent, I'm not consenting to it. They will say, oh, you're a sympathizer with men, with the exploiters, with the rapists, with the coercive agents of coercion. You're a sympathizer with them, and therefore you're guilty too. You share their guilt. But they say you can get out of that if you just don't sympathize with them anymore and join us, and then you'll be free of the guilt. That's the trip that laid on women. That's a tough one. Women say, wow, seems like such an easy way to get out of this guilt. It's amazing these spiritual teachers, how afraid they are of women, you know, as far as, oh, I've got to hug you, and you're so wonderful, we have such a loving relationship, and they're just jumping through hoops. They're jumping through hoops. They don't dare say the truth. Occasionally, they little slip, and then they say, everybody's going to abandon me if I keep saying that. I say, what the heck is going on? I mean, if you're really a teacher, stand up and speak the truth. Dismiss all this is nonsense. It's absolute nonsense. But you can tell they're running scared. A lot of them are running scared. It's obvious to me. Yeah, they're not, they don't have this true carefree quality of just dismissing this, and they can just say this is what's going on. I mean, it's important to say what's going on right now in the world to a certain extent. They say there is this coercion going on, and I haven't heard it coming. Maybe they're helping those who come to them develop immunity to the coercion. That we can presume that. But what I'm seeing is the women are running the show, absolutely running the show. 75% at least of these sanghas around spiritual teachers are all female. 75% and more. And the men, I notice the way they act. They're wallflowers. They're frightened because they realize there's some negotiation going on as far as their fate goes with this teacher and the women, and they feel maybe the teacher is negotiating on my behalf and it's going to save me, or maybe not, or maybe they're going to come to some agreement. Because there is, you can tell the women of the world are simply now saying, okay, we're negotiating with you. What is your agreement? What are you going to do? Just like that. We can remove the ambiguity. See, it's very brutal for men to have this ambiguity in relationships. Very brutal. Makes their life a living hell. So they want to get rid of this ambiguity. And so the women say, okay, we're going to ask something of you to get rid of this ambiguity. And then the ETs will tell them what. It gets passed through through the queen bees, through the culture. There's all sorts of ways that ETs have a way of letting it be known what is the demand to get rid of this ambiguity. And women will say, okay, we'll get rid of all the ambiguity forever, but we just need you to vacate your body right now during this time and place, because you're hindering our advancement. You're holding us back. You're putting a glass ceiling there. You're preventing us from our breakthrough. You are being sexist. You are standing in our way. You're trying to coerce us. We don't feel comfortable with you here. The whole thing, the world just doesn't feel comfortable. I don't feel comfortable. So you need to vacate. You know, it's just kind of like the women came in the workplace, and some of them, the feminists, would say, I don't feel comfortable with the culture here. I don't feel comfortable the way you look at me. I don't feel comfortable the way you talk. I don't feel comfortable. You have to change. And if you can't change, you have to lose your job. You got to leave because I'm here to stay, and you're making me feel uncomfortable, and you cannot adapt to me in the workplace. All this angle kept getting work. But now it's been globalized to the point where it says, you make me feel uncomfortable in the world. Therefore, you need to leave this world. You need to vacate your body here to make me feel comfortable. That's how it's being used now. And you will see that more and more and more. And so maybe some moment you'll have an epiphany, and you'll say, oh, I see it. And then you'll remember, I remember Clarity Ross explained all this very clearly a ways back. And okay, sure. And then you feel comfortable like saying, yeah, it's okay to see it that way. It absolutely is okay to see it that way. Not a bad person to see it that way. And you say, well, I don't want to see women as bad. Well, they have allowed themselves to be seduced into being agents of tremendous wickedness and delay, really. They've allowed themselves. They went along with it. That's their problem. It doesn't have to be your problem. You say, well, how can I relate to them? Well, you really can't, except through genuine satsang. You know, we're not supposed to be relating to one another here in this world. We're supposed to be relating to truth. That's what we're supposed to be relating to. We're civil to people. There's no problem being civil. I'm civil to everybody. I'm kind. I'm civil. I'm not some terrible person at all, but I don't have any desire to have some kind of loving relationship with somebody. No desire at all. The love is the truth. We love truth. We love reality. We love our home. That's what we love. The relationship we have here is with truth, with salvation. And you can just simply have a relationship with satsang, with inquiry, with truth, with contemplation of other people. I don't feel I'm missing out on anything, on any type of relationships or anything in the world at all, because I realize they're exploitive. They're absolutely exploitive. And men have been severely exploited over the last 50 years to the point where they're now trying to get men to wheels come off, to just completely collapse and just say, I can't go any further. I can't go any further. Or join the so-called party, which is not really a party at all. It is a death march, actually. Succumb to the demands of women, which is really just the ETs, which are really the attempt to fashion this world into their agenda, which is super rapid progress and change, which is an attempt to give the illusion of salvation, the illusion of salvation. Where you're so focused on how rapid the progress are, you don't even see that you're going backwards even faster. That's exactly what the intellect wants, is an illusion of salvation. So all this is geared towards that. That is the end game, really. And knowing what salvation really is, I say no dice. No deals, Mr. Bond or Mrs. Bond. And no, I know what salvation really is. So there's no deals. We're not making any deals. There's only one salvation, not two. The illusion of salvation is not salvation. It's actually regression. Things get worse when you go down that path. So I'm saying, no way, I'm not going down that path. So when you say, well, loving relationship, what could be a more loving relationship than willingness to speak the truth to the world that if you go down this path, you're going to regress? That's a loving relationship right there. It's a relationship based on truth. And how can you have a loving relationship that's not based on truth? Can you have a loving relationship based on lies and illusions? No, you cannot. No, you cannot. And we're finding that out right now. And they say, those who are saying, wait a minute, there's something crazy going on. They're being called misogynists, or that there's a war on women. They have some great war on women. Because why are they saying that? Because they're terrified that they're ready to play their trump card, and we might say no. And then we might start thinking and clarifying and say, wait a minute, what's been going on here? We've been duped, we've been tricked, we've been lied to, we've been deceived. They're trying to use guilt on us, fake guilt, to make us commit suicide. We say, well, we're not going to do that. And then the women are going to freak out and say, oh, they'll never have a loving relationship with us again. Well, not as a body mind, that is for sure. Absolutely not. But as a spirit of truth, which is what everyone is here, of course we will. We'll just say, this is the relationship is with truth. So we'll point to that. But as far as a body-mind relationship, no way. Never again. No way. The social contract has been completely broken by the women who decided that they thought they had a better way to create a utopia and didn't realize that the price of utopia was insisting that those who wouldn't go along with that commit suicide. They didn't see that, but ignorance is no excuse. Ignorance is no excuse, because the naivete and based on the vanity, etc., the willingness to be naive and not look based on their vanity. Hey, you cannot trust that. You cannot have a relationship with that. You cannot have a relationship with vanity or naivete. You cannot. You cannot have a loving relationship with that. You can only have a loving relationship with truth. That's it. Nothing else. So the way things would be configured is that men and women would go to inquiry, satsang, clarification. That's what they do. And they would respect one another for doing that. But as far as getting hot and heavy into personal, forget it. Forget it. That's easily exploitable by very wicked forces in the universe, very dark, delusional forces who have been going on this path of progress for so long, they haven't realized how far they've regressed. They become very dark and delusional, very dark. And they just exploit others with this crazy false path of salvation, of progress, the path of progress, a false path. And they come in and contaminate worlds, mislead worlds, deceive worlds. And they know through long experience that females can be exploited. They're the real exploiters, you know, through various inducements. And vanity is a very strong inducement. It's a weak spot. Just like men have a weakness for women, women have a weakness for vanity. So we both have weaknesses, and so we can be exploited by those who are dark enough to exploit this. Absolutely. And they have. That's exactly what's happened here. Step by step, I've seen the entire thing happen. I just didn't know what the end game was. So I had a little doubt. I was saying, I'm not wrong, but I can't understand what the end game is. And now I see the end game, and then the whole thing fits. The glove fits. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit. But if it does fit, you do not acquit. So we're not acquitting here. The ETs, their agenda, how they've used the women of the world, how they've used the advertising, the marketing, and the pop culture, everything to... And then they're pushing all this guilt onto men and then saying, here's how you make reparations for this severe guilt that we have told you you're guilty of. And if you don't think you're guilty, then you're complete. You're too stupid to understand it, and you don't deserve to go along. You deserve to commit suicide just because you're totally stupid. I mean, the smartest men in the world recognize that, hey, there's something really weird going on here, very bogus. They spoke up. Some spoke up. I know there was at least one who was an actor who spoke up, and he got hammered. I could trace down who it was. Vilified. Any of the men that spoke up were absolutely vilified. I mean, I watched it. I watched it happen. They were vilified, and the women in their lives vilified them. Their mothers, their aunts, their uncles, their aunts, their nieces, their cousins, their female friends, the entire range of their female life vilified them and said, you're a woman hater or something. Listen, if someone is doing something that's hateful, pointing it out doesn't mean you're hateful. If someone's lying, what's worse, lying and deceiving or pointing out the lie and deception? It's obvious. It's the one who's lying and deceiving that is the one that shouldn't be able to say that the ones who point it out are the wicked ones. That's not true. It's not true. That's reversing things upside down. But those who spoke up or said, "Oh, you hate us," or something. You're hating women. You're one of those terrible men that are saying, "No. I hate what." The deal you've been making. I hate what you're doing because I feel like you're leading us to our demise, to our destruction. What's going to be utilized in a very nasty way. That is what I felt. Eventually this is going to be used in an extremely nasty way. And it hasn't happened yet, but it will be. And then people would say, you're nuts. You're crazy. No, you're just a misogynist. No, it's not true. It's not true. Because because initially I was a champion of women's liberation, and before it got taken over, you know, twisted, I said, no, I want women to be independent. I want them to be strong. I want them to be spiritually clear. I want them to feel they have the path to clarity. They have every, as much right to men to that path of salvation. 100%, that is, I'm 100% that way. Absolutely, they have every right as much as men to see, clarify the path of salvation. And that's what I want for all women, to realize that they're problem free. All men, all women, exactly the same. So there's no misogyny there whatsoever. But when something tries to distract from the path of salvation and is trying to very much delay and mislead, I'll point it out. I'll point it out because that's what I'm supposed to do that. I don't care who, if men are trying to mislead, I'll point it out too. Just the same. Makes no difference to me whatsoever. Makes no difference what race the people are, what gender what they are, what orientation they are. Makes no difference. If there's someone who's trying to distract, mislead, and go and push an agenda which is very inimical and is actually supporting the false path of salvation, I'll point it out. I'll point it out. And of course, the laws have been changed, and they're changing them as fast as possible to criminalize pointing this out. That's exactly what they're doing. So, in using revisionism, which they will certainly do, what they're doing now is they're having crimes of revisionism. In other words, stuff that was perfectly legal at a certain time frame, they're now saying that it should have been illegal, therefore it is illegal, and we're going to punish you for what you did in the past, even though it wasn't illegal then. That was simply, they say that you had coerced the legal system so that it wouldn't be illegal, but now that we see that it should be illegal, we're going to retroactively apply that to you. That's called retroactive law. That is what they're going for now. So, of course, saying these things will be seen as completely illegal in the near future, what I'm saying right now. I'm aware of that. It's going to be seen as, like, the most illegal thing possible. And you're listening to is also being seen to be completely illegal, etc. Of course. Exactly. But you don't need to give your consent, do you? When they say, this is your punishment, you don't need to give your consent to it. They say, well, you've got this massive mountain of guilt, and you got to make reparations for it. It's your karma. You got to make reparations, and this is we'll actually make you a great deal. We'll let all this karma go if you just agree to vacate your body or be re-educated. And you say, no deal. What I am has no karma. How could what I am have karma? What I am has no problems. Reality can never be threatened. What is real can never be threatened. Therefore, it can't have any real karma. This whole karma is just a complete made-up thing, complete ruse. You're asking me to actually empower the false path of salvation. I won't do it. I won't do it. You can stand up to that. You don't have to give consent to be punished. You do not. You do not. All punishment is consensual, but consent can be derived at in tricky ways by using this leverage of karma, bad karma. You're like healing them of karma. This punishment is burning off karma or something. Now, of course, some men in the past did use these pressure tactics on women. There's no question about it. Absolutely. But the remedy is to see the true path of salvation. It's not to twist it around and two wrongs don't make a right. Two wrongs do not make a right. Certainly, in history, men have coerced women have tricked them, laid out something saying, this is going to burn off your karma, all the wickedness that you did before. This whole thing goes on and on and on, because when the matriarchy was in charge long ago, they were incredibly bad to men, horrible. I mean, beyond anything we can hardly even imagine. They viewed men as lower than cattle, completely expendable, just they're slaves. And they felt all this bad karma, and they need to expiate this bad karma. Then some men would say, okay, you become our slaves, and then you know, we'll burn that off, and et cetera, et cetera. That, of course, this dynamic has been going on and on and on. But two wrongs don't make a right. Absolutely don't. Absolutely do not. It only empowers the false path even more, meaning you're more locked into seeing your progress instead of seeing that you're going backsliding, regressing, even into greater darkness and delusion. You don't see it. So at some point, you have to break this vicious circle, this vicious spiral that is spiraling you down and down and down. You have to break through that. Someone has to say, hey, let's call the whole thing off. We never had it. What we are, never has never had a problem. I'm positive that this presence of the true self is within you as much as it's within me. It's within everyone. You just have to invite it in. Just accept it. Say, I'll accept this feeling of being problem free. And you realize, I've never had a problem. Then how can I demand reparations from anybody? It's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. You have to give up judgment, guilt, reparations. You have to be willing to give that up. Because in your heart, you might be thinking, yeah, but somebody's done me wrong, and I'm going to wait until I get reparations from them. I'm going to champion some political leader who's going to demand reparations of them, which is what happened this last election, is he had enough people on this country who were demanding, waiting for, wanted reparations, thinking that's their salvation. They're willing to support a candidate who promised them, tacitly promised them, that they're going to get those reparations. So they said, well, I'll vote that way because I feel I'm going to be getting all these reparations. In various ways. That's literally what happened. But so you need to give up reparations. Say, no, since I don't have any problems, what the heck do I need reparations for? Since I'm perfect, I'm flawless, I'm completely blissful, why do I need to wait around for reparations? That's insane, totally insane. You say, I don't need any. I'm not going to wait around. All is forgiven because nothing ever happened. All is forgiven because nothing ever happened to this self, which is what I really am. Nothing ever happened to it. So, all is forgiven right now. Everybody can do that. And that is the only way to salvation, is to say, all is forgiven. I'm not waiting for reparations anymore. That's a delusional path. Totally delusional path. And yet the world decided that it's going to go for reparations. The majority decided reparations is the way to go. I'm just telling it like it is. Not out of hate of anyone at all, because the true self is within everybody. I know that for a fact. But there are those who truly are offering reparations as a means to power, as a means to control, as a means to get elected. And that is not helpful to anybody. They're not your friend at all. They're leading you, they're a Pied Piper leading you down into deep, deep, deep confusion and delay. Where your focus becomes so narrow that you're not even aware that you're going backwards. You're not even aware. Realizing you're going backwards is a great thing. So wait a minute, I'm going backwards. Why? Why? Because I'm waiting for reparations. I'm believing progress is the answer. I'm empowering a false path. And you say, whoa, I don't need to do that. And then your backwards progress starts being slowed. Your regression starts slowing down. So the faster you try to go forward, the faster you go backwards, the more you go backwards. So if you just stop trying to solve problems, then you say, wait a minute, I'm not going backwards hardly at all here. And then you say, hey, maybe I can accept the presence of the problem-free self that I am. Then I realize I never had problems. It's all been a dream. Then you're free. That's how you get free. So, of course, we are in a nasty situation now because we have a situation now where, again, 80% of the world seems to think that reparations is the way to go. That's a wise and super fast progress and reparations for legal laws being applied retroactively is the way to go. That equal results is the way to go, even though you get people doing one going in one direction, the other going in another direction, supposed to get equal results from that. You know, which is insane. Equal results, retroactive legal application, the domination of feminism, which is really demanding that those who don't want to go along with this plan, this overall global plan, are supposed to vacate their bodies, commit suicide. All 80% of the world says, yeah, that's the way to go. So obviously there's a minority of people in the world who are wise enough to say, they know this doesn't seem like this is not the real plan of salvation. And of course, those who have been attuned to religions, at least they might have some idea. They may not know exactly what is it, but they have some idea what's not it. At least that's a step in the right direction. You know what's not it. That at least narrows the search down for you. They can say, wait a minute. This whole thing that's going on in the world is just agenda. That's not it. That is not salvation. That's not what Christ was telling us, or Krishna, or Buddha, whatever. That's not what they were saying. That's not it. And that just because they don't know what's it doesn't mean they can say, that no, this is not it. Very few of them know what really is it. They don't. But they have a feeling, they know, at least they know enough to say, well, that this is not it. That's a step in the right direction. That shouldn't be mocked at all. I don't mock religion. even though I know that they're confused about what is the answer, I don't mock them at all. I say, you know, hey, it's a good step to at least have some idea of what's not it. That's helpful, very helpful. Why should they be mocked or scorned? You know, why? Just because they don't have it all, they're not completely clear. Well, at least they're got some clarity of what's not it. That's a positive step. And then from there, they need to go further. And most of them say, we don't want to go further. They were kind of scared to go further. And I said, well, you know, you don't want to just stagnate, because those who are pushing this agenda on you, they will push you into vacating your body. They'll push guilt on you. It'll be nasty. It'll be a nasty war. If you don't vacate your body consensually, then they'll demand a war with you. And you'll consent to that. For me, I don't consent to any war. I'm not in any conflict with delusion at all. None. So no war. I'm not vacating my body. I'm not getting engaged in any fight or any war or argument or any. I don't consent to any of that. But the problem is, a lot of religious people will consent to a war. And of course, they won't win that war. See, when the ETs and their agenda and their proxies and those here that have engaged with them have enough power, which they do now, then they will either say, let's say one, either vacate your body if you don't consent to that, okay, let's have an all-out war. Because they know they can win the war now. They know. They know they can win it. And those who are religious people who say, okay, we'll consent to that, we won't consent to vacating, we'll consent to a war, they're going to be wiped out. They're going to be wiped out. The third secret of Fatima in Portugal was seeing that religious people are going to get slaughtered. That's what it was. That was accurate. You know, also saw problems with the sun. You know, there will be problems with the sun here, believe me. But the slaughter of religious people is most certainly going to happen, because they will consent to a war. And I don't consent to any such war. Absolutely. And they all believe that Jesus is going to come back and lead them to victory in that war. That is not true. Jesus doesn't consent to any war, because he knows it's totally delusional. There are no problems in reality. We are one with reality. Our true identity has no problems at all. So what will we be fighting? What will we be protecting, defending, fighting for? For what? Just realize, accept the truth, accept the presence of what you are. Accept Christ, the presence of Christ within you, and you're saved. That's all anyone can do. And you have to consent to a war. You'd have to consent to it. And if you say we have to have a war, you're saying there is no other place. This world's the only place there is, which is delusional. You're limiting the capacity of Christ to manifest the world for you. You're not having real faith at all. A lot of religious people think this is the only planet, their only home. This is their home, their true home, and they have to hold on to it. Therefore, they see that they're going to be, this new agenda's coming, and they'll consent to a war to try and triumph. No, there's no need for any triumph. Christ can manifest an infinite number of planets, habitable planets, if you want, if you ask him to. He will. Our true self, Christ, our true self, can manifest anything in this dream. You can go to another place if you want to. But the manipulation of this planet is such, you're being manipulated into conflict to try and triumph over you. You know, there's those who believe in triumph. When you believe in triumph over, what does reality need to triumph over? What? Nothing. There's nothing to triumph over. It's completely delusional. You only amplify delusion by getting into conflict. You can just say, oh, I don't consent to any war. I don't consent to leave my body. I don't consent to any war. And you might say, but you know, I don't really like hanging out with this agenda here that the world is wrapped up into. So, I'll go somewhere else. I'll voluntarily go somewhere else. I'll have a place that Christ has manifested for me. This, my true self reality can manifest in the dream, a dwelling place, and I'll say, I'll go there. But I don't have any hatred for anyone. I'm not gonna be in conflict. I'm not in conflict with lies at all. I just see this planet is no longer interested in being witnessed to. So, okay, we'll wait. We'll wait until you're ready. That's all. You can have that attitude. If people don't want to be witnessed to, okay. And if they decide that you're no longer welcome in this planet, okay, that's all right. It's not a problem. Why should we get into a war about that, a conflict? No reason whatsoever. They say, yeah, they'll take over this planet. Good luck with that. Because the sun is going to have some big impact here. The planet is going to be remodeled, actually. So it'll be a very Pyrrhic victory. Very Pyrrhic victory. And no victory. Oh, reality doesn't need to win any victory. So instead of gauging people in a contest of where there's a winner and loser and triumph, etc., that just amplifies delusion. So you're not helping anybody by getting into a conflict with them, not helping anyone that way. So if they're gung-ho on a conflict, you can just say, okay, you know, if that's what you're insisting, that's what you really want right now, if you think you want, okay, I'll just vacate. I won't vacate my body. I'll take my body with me, and we'll just vacate the planet and let you have the planet. You can have the planet and proceed along the line you want, because I'm not going to amplify your delusion for you. Not a problem. But certainly, you say, we're not going to do any harm to ourselves or any of our imaginary selves or whatever. We're not going to do any harm either. We're not going to attack anything. We're not going to attack ourselves. We're not going to commit suicide. We're not going to get in any war. None of that. But we will, if necessary, vacate the planet by going to another better place. Much better place, actually. And of course, those here saying, ah, you're the bad guys. You don't deserve to go to a better place. We want to see you dead. We want to triumph over you. See, that's what they want to triumph over you, to show that they're right, that their plan of salvation is right and yours is wrong. They want a contest. Truth is not decided by a contest. Reality is not at the mercy of consensus. Conflicts decide nothing. Reality is not something that's decided upon. It is created by the Prime Creator as it is. All we can do is decide to accept it or not. And ultimately, we have no choice in that either. It's just a matter of delay. How much are we going to delay? So contest won't decide anything. So you'd be wise to say, why engage in a contest? It's completely meaningless. Completely meaningless. But those here with this agenda of progress, etc., the false path, they want to reinforce their delusions that they're right by getting into a contest with religious people and triumphing over them to say, you see, we're right and you're wrong. Because if God was with you, you would have won the contest, etc. So that's insane to engage with that. Just say, if you really are insisting on a contest, a competition, we're not in on that. And if you really want to press it far enough, we'll just vacate, we'll just shift to another location. And then you'll fight among yourselves or whatever. But we're not going to amplify your insanity by getting into any contest with you. That is for sure. Because to do so would be to imply that we believe that reality needs to be protected, that reality needs to be defended, that reality has a problem with being attacked. And none of that is true. That only amplifies delusion. So we'll say, no, we'll just sidestep this whole situation until you are tired of your delusions enough to entertain truth again, and we'll get after it again when you're ready. That's not a problem. It's not a problem. It's not a problem at all. Easy as pie. It's not difficult to point to the truth, to point it out. It's not difficult. It's not difficult at all. So we won't vacate our bodies. We won't engage in any conflicts. And if that becomes too upsetting, then we will simply relocate. And it may come to that. It may very well. I see it coming to that, actually. The blueprint, the way, the momentum, the way things are going, is very likely relocation will take place. Very likely. Maybe it's like 99%, but I cannot go 100% at this point. I don't want to go to 100% at this point. But certainly the underpinnings need to be seen clearly as why it may be necessary simply so you don't amplify the insanity of those who are on this planet, and you know, don't amplify it. It would actually cause them problems. If you want to be compassionate, it may be they need to relocate, truly. Because the demand for conflict will become very severe on this planet. And the demand you vacate your body, which would be in conflict with your own imagination, which was, this is not the goal either. Suicide is not the goal at all. God's not calling for that at all. So vacating your body, say, no, that's not helping anyone. That's like saying, oh, admitting you're so wrong, you're so guilty. This is a payment for bad karma, which is all delusional. You're not wrong, you're not guilty, there's no such thing as karma. None, no such thing at all. It's all imaginary. So that would just enhance imagination, enhance illusion, enhance delay. So don't do that. Don't get in conflict. That is showing your love and compassion for your brothers and sisters by refusing to be in conflict with their insanity, refusing to engage in a conflict over their insanity, refusing to believe their insanity, refusing to go along with insanity, refusing to go along with that agenda. All of that, saying, no, I won't do that, that's actually helping them. They may not think that, but it is. See, they want a victory. But to put yourself in a situation in that context is actually hurting them. The idea that somehow lies can triumph over truth is insane. So if you really, the love is expressed by not going along with their insanity, not enhancing it. And at some point, the expression of that love may be to relocate. And those who do relocate are actually those who have profound love, who are in touch with profound compassion and love in this way. Not that they're having loving relationships here, like hugging people and saying, oh, I love you so much. I'll love you forever. You're so wonderful. No. That's real compassion, real love is expressed with wisdom. Hold on, someone's coming. This is enough for this video. All right, that's it.